Championship Tour, America's Winter Championship. My name is TJ. I'm joined on the sidebar by Cora and Rob. And we're about to jump into our next matchup. Before we do that, I want to get your guys' thoughts on that last match. You think Nostrum would take it all the way after that win? Cora?
I do. I think Nostrum is one of the better-known players, but still sort of an underdog coming in, especially going up against Chalky in the first match. So I was really excited to see that he took it, and he took it pretty easily, but I don't think we should count out Chalky just yet.
Yeah, I would be surprised if Chalky didn't manage to turn this around. He really does have the confidence, and he's coming in here with what he feels is the best roster you could possibly bring to this. So happy for Nostrum, but at the same time, Chalky, close buddy of mine, so I'm still rooting for him.
All right, well, let's move to the second matchup of Group A and start talking about these next players. So we're going to introduce our very first player for the second match of the day. It is going to be hailing from Oakville, Ontario. It's Talion.
Talion is one of the more underdog players coming into this, but as we can see from his video later on, he's also very confident, so we should, much like Nostrum, not count him out just yet.
We can see from his intro, look at all that swag. Talion's no underdog, he's got style.
Yeah, and Talion was a player who, again, was sort of unknown working through the winter preliminaries, but he's been around the competitive scene for a while. You may have read some of his popular decks on Hearthstone, a big guide maker for a lot of popular decks in Hearthstone, so definitely a player to look out for moving forward in this tournament. But let's introduce his opponent, the second player for the second match of the day. It is Amnesiac.
Speaking of a player to look out for, don't let Amnesiac's age fool you. He's 15, but he's ready to rough people up here. Come in here and put down a grown man performance. And Amnesiac, all that confidence, all that swagger. This is a guy who, like Chalky, he comes in here believing he is absolutely the best. He is here to punish people, and very excited to see what Amnesiac brings.
Yeah, these are two of the most confident players, I think, on the entire field. So I'm really looking forward to getting into this one. Amnesiac touted as sort of the prodigy of Hearthstone, you know, says some of the, sometimes it comes easy to him. He was just a natural hit legend in his very first season that he ever played. So really looking forward to this matchup. Cora?
Only 15 years old, Amnesiac, but already a member of Team Archon, one of the most prominent Hearthstone teams in the business right now, so we can't count out either of these players. Talion, obviously walking in with quite a bit of swagger, some confidence. Look at that sweater. I mean, both of these guys seem like they're really ready to go.
Yeah, Talion rocking that Drake sweater, and we see, you know, Talion was really well-rested. He spent a lot of time resting up and sleeping over the course of the last few days, so really excited to see what Talion brings after approximately 58 hours of sleep in 2 days.
All right, well, now that the players have been introduced, let's send it over to our casters to get into the action.
Thank you, TJ. Welcome back to the Tavern. My name is Sottle, joined here on the desk by Savitz and Reynad, and I'm enormously looking forward to this matchup. Let's talk a little bit about these players. Amnesiac, as the sidebar there, elaborated on a little bit. Very, very confident young man, bordering on cocky at times, but as we'll hear a little bit more from Talion as well later on, he's a very confident young man himself. Reynard, you have a little bit of experience of expressing confidence in certain situations and having it pay off and maybe not pay off. You know, does it put any more pressure on you as a player?
Not too much. I can't recall ever losing a game of Hearthstone personally, so I can't imagine it not paying off. But yeah, I mean, it's definitely good to have that kind of confidence behind your plays, especially in a tournament setting. You know, there's a lot of pressure in a lot of cases here, and you definitely want to feel confident that you're going to be the one to win.
Yeah, so just looking at a bit of extra information here about Talion. Studies actuarial science at university. I personally have no idea what that entails, but wants to make Hearthstone a full-time career. And was very devastated by his stream loss to Chalky in the preliminaries. Wants to come back from that heavily. So why don't you tell us a little bit about Amnesiac?
Yeah, only 15 years old. He's the youngest player in the tournament, and he still considers his biggest priority to be school. But he has played a lot of Hearthstone too, and does it quite well. Has reached Legend number one with multiple decks and multiple seasons. Plays with him Archon. Maybe one of the favorites to potentially win this entire event.
Right. The really impressive thing about Amnesiac is, as you said, he's not one of the full-time Hearthstone players yet. He still has commitments with school, commitments with sports as well. But some incredible stats coming out of him. He's played over 25,000 games of Hearthstone, 10,000 games with Druid. He's hit Legend in every season that he's played the game, 24 out of 24. So if you take that back, he hit Legend in his first season as a 13-year-old. Pretty impressive stuff.
Yeah, definitely. That's quite an amazing feat. I don't think many people have done the same thing. It's going to be exciting to see him play against Talion, how he's going to match up.
You guys can vote at home who you think is going to win this series. You can use the hashtag HCT alongside the hashtag either Talion or Amnesiac to vote for who you think is going to win. But just looking at these lineups here, Reynard, how do you feel about how these lineups are matching up?
It definitely could be anyone's game. I have to give a slight edge to Amnesiac, I think. I feel like Rogue's a very strong choice, as well as Warrior for this tournament. And Paladin, really, even in the matchups that aren't necessarily favored for it, it's not too bad. So I like Amnesiac's lineup here a little bit more, I think.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about Amnesiac's Warrior, because I would expect that to be Patron Warrior. We can't know for sure, but it would fit his style a little bit better, I would imagine.
Yeah, looking at Amnesiac's stats, he is very much a confident Rogue player. Rogue is very much a comfort pick to bring to a tournament. It's not a deck you bring unless you're incredibly comfortable with it. Looking at his stats, his account has a 62% win rate with Rogue overall lifetime. Anything above 60 is massive, so 62 shows a great deal of competence.
Oh, looks like I was wrong. We got a double brawl from Amnesiac. He's going to start out with the Warrior, and with those brawls, it has to be a control Warrior.
Yeah, maybe one Brawl can get teched into like a tournament meta Patron deck as a surprise, but double Brawl in Patron seems kind of ridiculous. Does look like he's going to be Control Warrior, and this looks like a Reno lock from Talion here. Reynard, favorites in this matchup for you?
Ooh, it's really a tough call, and this is a card that it's really going to hinge on, in my opinion, and that's Harrison Jones.
Okay.
I think that, assuming both players kind of have the right macro, big picture, long-term strategy, the Reno lock should be able to win a Jiraxxus unless the Warrior has the Harrison to follow it up. So that's kind of usually how this matchup ends up playing out. But again, this can go either way because it's going to be a very long matchup most of the time. Both players are going to draw their decks, get very close to fatigue. There's a lot of room in games like that to make misplays. And games like this really show who's the better player in a lot of cases.
Yeah, if that is a Reno Warlock from Talion, I'm really interested to see his particular deck choices, because you have to put 30 different cards into the deck, and a lot of players tend to prefer to play different type of win conditions, for example. Oh, double Dark Peddler.
Oh, that's awesome. That's hand lock. Or no, yeah, it's combo lock.
It's combo lock, yeah.
Combo lock.
Interesting
with,
stuff.
Yeah, with the likely either with an Arcane Golem or a Leroy Jenkins.
Yep, two copies of Dark Peddler to try and pick up those extra burst damage sources like the Abusive Sergeant's Power Overwhelming, etc. But how does that information now change this matchup, Sabine?
I think Talion might be in big trouble. This is not a good matchup at all. The damage potential, even with those Dark Peddlers potentially giving extra Power Overwhelmings, it's still limited, and the Warrior can go above 30 health.
Yeah, so for the people unfamiliar with the Warlock combo deck, because it is a little bit rare on ladder, the main goal is to basically draw through your deck, at some point maybe play an Alexstrasza, get your opponent kind of lower on health, and then play either a Leroy Jenkins or an Arcane Golem, buff it up with Power Overwhelmings, copy it with Faceless Manipulator, and you have two massive charge minions that hit your opponent for, you know, potentially like 28 damage sometimes.
Right.
So essentially, the reason the Warlock or the Warrior matchup is a little bit tough for this Warlock deck is because the Warrior's decks nowadays, because of Justicar, True Heart, Shield Block, Bash, they have access to just so much armor. A lot of times you can get up to a life total where it's actually impossible for the Warlock to win the game. So the small little details of these draws, like for example, Amnesiac not having a Fiery War Axe, is a really big deal, because that's going to let Talion's Peddlers keep chipping away at armor and really make it actually possible for him to win.
Yeah, the early damage points are extremely important for Talion. Like you mentioned, the combo can deal up to maybe 28 damage, but 58 after Justicar is a whole different animal. So these early damage points with the Peddlers, with the Azure, with the Twilight Drake, that might give Talion a good chance to maybe even take this unfavorable matchup down.
Yep, Fiery War Axe and Deathbite both come into hand now for Amnesiac, so he does have the opportunity to start controlling this board a little bit, which, as you say, is very important because he is going to want to build up that armor buffer, because what very much now? Against like Freeze Mage, your armor is the thing that's resistant to the Alexstrasza. So, you know, you can have a massive health pool and you can still be under threat of two-turn lethal from a burst deck. But if you can build up that armor, it gives you a much more secure platform.
So Amnesiac's a very experienced player in Hearthstone. A very small detail here from his perspective is he sees the second Dark Peddler. That kind of gives away that it's not Reno Warlock. So I think Amnesiac should be able to pin it down to combo Warlock, except it's not.
More and more cards are getting drawn here, I thought this when we saw the Doomguard, we may have to reevaluate again. It looks like this is just maybe a demon build of Handlock, just a control Warlock with no Reno, basically. Just valuing high value threats from the Void Caller, Mal'Ganis, Doomguard, potentially Jiraxxus, massive Twilight Drakes from having a large hand as well. So forget everything we we just said about burst damage combos, this is more along the lines of what we talked about initially, where the Warlock will try and win the game through attrition, having a large resource, tapping every turn, make sure they have all the fuel, and the Control Warrior will try and stem the tide and try and set up an aggressive kill later in the game.
Yeah, that's really good news for Talion. It gives him a much better chance, because if you're playing those demons, there's going to be a Lord Charaxxus somewhere in the deck.
Yes.
And getting that Charaxxus on the board early on, having those unlimited Infernals, it can be tricky for the Warrior to end the game fast enough.
Right, we actually saw a really high-level play in the America's prelims. I believe it was from Owl Sky High, who, while he was ahead on board in this matchup as the Warlock, played a Doomsayer just so his opponent would play nothing, and then followed it up with turn 9 Jiraxxus on an empty board just because he knew how important that 6-6 every turn was. So he actually sacrificed a board lead for the long-time investment of a safe Jiraxxus.
Yeah, Warrior is known as one of the best classes at removing threats with those Exeggs, with those shield slams and the weapons. There's a lot of removal, and quite often in some matchups like against Rogue, you can simply kill each and every minion, but with those Infernals, it's a little bit different.
Yeah, so that's the beauty of the Warlock deck, is just every single card that's drawn, it can represent an entirely new archetype. Just a lot of flexibility in the class. So this is a kind of the newer take on the old Handlock decks nowadays. A lot of times you're seeing fewer Mountain Giants and kind of more of this Voidcaller type of strategy. More mid-game spells, things like Dark Peddler. I do think that long-term, this is still a matchup that can go either way, and it's still going to hinge on Harrison Jones, because any Warlock deck with Jiraxxus, that's kind of your plan A against slower Warrior decks that are trying to remove everything. That Gore Hell picked up from Amnesiac here, it's actually a very uncommon card seen in Warrior decks these days, but it's exceptional in this matchup. It's one of the best cards you could draw. That's going to be able to deal with Emperor Thorsen, Sludge Belchers, all these minions that you normally have to commit spells to dealing with. You can now just deal with a single weapon.
Right, and even that Mal'Ganis is an emergency answer. We see no Execute or Shield Slam in his hand right now, so if this Mal'Ganis is summoned onto the board, he may just have to take that 9 damage to face and use the Gore Howl to remove it.
Yeah, Gore Howl in some matchups is quite weak. If you're playing against an aggressive strategy, 7 mana weapon, it simply comes too late. But in this matchup, where the game is expected to go very long, certainly is powerful.
Super interesting turn here from Talion. He had a lot of options there. So he Life Tap, draws the second Mortal Coil. That opens up the line of play where he double Mortal Coils the Sylvanas. He decides to just make use of that Corruption instead, which is a heads-up play because, you know, that card, when you get it off a Dark Peddler, usually pretty underwhelming. It's good to get value out of it when you can.
Yes, we are going to see the Gore Hell come down here, take out a 7 health minion. Not the Mal'Ganis I talked about, but still, using it to destroy the Doomguard there. Great use of it. Passes the initiative back to Talion, though. But with that, the tempo of that Gore Hell now already invested, it's going to be much harder for him to stick a minion to the board.
And that's just the power of that card in this matchup. Because he's Talion now, there's nothing he'd love to do more than just slam an Emperor Thoris in an empty board. But when Gore Hell just deals with it for 0 mana, it's really hard to justify that play. So it's very likely we see a Life Tap plus Healbot come out here.
Yeah, I think he might just go for the Emperor anyway. It is 5 damage to Amnesiac's base from the weapon usage, and there's some damage in Talion's hand already. But I wouldn't blame him for that play that you suggested, just getting that extra card, dropping a Healbot.
Yeah, another advantage to not using the Healbot this turn is that it's going to make it easier to play Molten Giants later in the game, which is a card that Talion's very likely to have. We've already seen Sunfear, Protector, Defender of Argus. It's a very common card in these decks.
Yeah, and also just making sure you Life Tap every turn in this matchup is pretty important where you can, because we can see right now that the Warlock who has the card draw hero power is not stretching out a resource advantage over the Warrior at this point. And in fact, that Gore Howl is going to push a resource advantage towards the Warrior, because it can potentially pick up a 4 or 5 for 1.
Yeah, another reason to potentially wait with the Emperor Thorisson would have been to try to find that Lord Jiraxxus before playing it, because it's so powerful when you get to play it for 8 mana and Infernal straight away later on in the game.
That Soulfire being picked up earlier in the game is actually going to allow Talion to kind of threaten more burst damage than Amnesiac might expect coming out of a Handlock deck. Usually you feel pretty safe at even low life totals against a slower Warlock deck like this. But, you know, if you manage to pick up a couple Dark Bombs, Soulfire, Hellfire, a lot of times you can just deal a lot of damage out of nowhere and kill the Warrior from a position where he feels comfortable. And, you know, that is... Gore Howl, as good of a card as it is, does have a significant drawback in that you eat a ton of damage to get full value out of it. So this game might come down to being ended with a flurry of burn spells at some point.
Very absolutely true. And it looks like Talion wants to go digging with his Mortal Coils here. First one not going to draw a card, but the second one will, and he wants to find something more. What's going to be? A Twilight Drake. That's a great card to pick up.
Yeah, Twilight Drake comes down as a 4-7 here, so still big enough to contest that Gore Howl, but he's actually going to go ahead and use the Healbot here instead. How do we feel about this?
I like that line of play. He knows that Amnesiac, his hand is pretty big. It's going to start getting clogged up with weapons. So Amnesiac's going to want to attack every single turn. So just by playing Healbot, you know it's going to get attacked, whether Amnesiac wants to or not. So the longer you wait to play your big minion, the more likely it is to survive.
I personally find it a little bit surprising because of the Molten Giant that he picked up earlier. Because he was fairly close to already getting the Molten down. Just a couple of more life taps and he would have been able to play it for... Even if it costs still a 10 mana, you can still play it as a threat on the board. So, in my opinion, this might have been a little bit premature healing effect there.
Yeah, it seems to suggest that Talion is set out for the long game here as we see second Molten Giant being drawn now, which punishes the Healbot a little bit more, but seems like his line here is to play the long game, try and exhaust the value of that Gore Howl, as Reynard said, just with less powerful minions, and then restart the game afterwards, hoping that Jiraxxus is drawn at some point, as we've discussed at length as well. So it makes some sense, but yeah, surprised not to see the Twilight Drake come down this turn, and now he's stuck in the same position. Like, is he going to play the Twilight Drake this turn? Are we going to see another Healbot? Like, What's the merit in just delaying the Drake for one turn, though?
I feel like Talion has a pretty good line of play in this case. He gets to life tap, you know, trade in the Owl, Hellfire, play that Drake, and kind of just face a weaker weapon. You know, maybe some combination of slams and bashes don't deal with it anymore. Last turn, if you were to play Drake as a 4-7, it would have died to just slam plus the Gore Howl, so right. It would have cost zero cards to deal with one of his larger threats.
He's not going to go for it, though. I certainly like that line. In some cases, you want to try to hit multiple minions with your AoE effects, but in this particular matchup, I think it's fine to just use the Hellfire on one minion. But he chooses to keep that and just play the Drake.
Yeah, and Amnesiac's hand here is starting just to stack up with removal options, but I wouldn't line up perfectly here. He can attack into the Twilight Drake and bash. That's a nice clean 8 damage, but as Reynard said, he wants to be attacking with that weapon every turn because of that extra Deathbite and Fiery War Axe that he has now clogged up in his hand.
I expect Amnesiac to run out one of these Revenges. You definitely don't need both in this matchup. Oh, he's actually going to take this line of play, save the Revenge, put a bunch of damage on his Shield Maiden, and end up armoring up again. So this is a heads-up play. Amnesiac had the option to kind of preserve health on his Shield Maiden and go face, but he knows both Mortal Coils have been used, so it's going to live, and he's playing around Molten Giants.
Exactly. That 5-1 is so valuable right now with both of the coils being played. The Baylor did pick up two cards, but those coils that were casted I guess there could be one more coil somewhere in there. He doesn't know that it's Soulfire, but still, so powerful.
He does know that those Mortal Coils were not off of Peddler, but yeah, there is that small chance. Oh, he's gonna opt for just the Dr. Boom straight up, so still holding on to Hellfire.
Yeah, it looks like he's gonna Soulfire the 5-1 just to try and protect his Boom here, make him need an answer beyond that 5-1 on the board. Way too much value to let that thing attack into the 7-7. But speaking of answers, Mr. Big Game Hunter off the top is about as perfect an answer as you can get.
Yeah, that's the dream card for Amnesiac to draw right there. Dr. Boom comes down, first 7 or more power minion getting played, and perfect timing. BJ is taking perfectly care of it.
I'm actually surprised that Amnesiac played the Big Game Hunter there. I feel like that card, you know it's going to have value at some point because you know your opponent's going to play Mal'Ganis. You've seen Voidcaller.
Sure.
So he had the option to go Revenge plus Execute, and then that would have meant that there isn't a Boombot on board to potentially answer this 4-2 right away. But he opted to just use the BGH right away, save that Execute for later, because it is a more flexible card. You can use it on Infernals, things like that. So yeah, both plays definitely solid, but definitely a lot of options there for Amnesiac.
Yeah, it's two opportunities that Amnesiac has had to use a Revenge here as for some sort of utility, but he is holding on to them, so I'm wondering if he does have bigger plans. I guess the combination of both of them can come together to deal with any size board of 6/6s if his health is lowered, but that seems a little bit desperate too late in the game to make too big of an impact. So I wonder what his plan is long-term for these Revenges.
Well, there we go.
There we go.
First one getting used. He needed a way to deal damage to that giant in order to be able to execute it. And the Revenge didn't look all that valuable, so.
Worth noting as well, this is a really greedy list from Talion. We've seen Voidcallers, Twilight Drakes, and Mountain Giants alongside the Demon package that's necessary to have those Voidcallers. So, ton of threats in this deck overall.
Absolutely, but he's out of those threats that he has in his hand right now. Those Molten Giants are still unavailable. He's found something more.
Yeah, the first 6 charges of Gore Howl got full value. That's definitely going to make this game tough for Talion. You know, that's so many of those mid-sized minions that you kind of need to trade for more than weapon durability gone out of his deck. He is life tapping, whereas the Warrior is drawing significantly fewer cards, so usually the Warlock gets the fatigue a lot faster in the game. That's gonna come up fairly soon, and at that point, cards like Gromash can threaten to just kill you out of nowhere.
Absolutely, and there's the Mal'Ganis, and Amnesiac doesn't really have that good of an answer to it yet. He can play the Death Spite and use the Belcher and his face to deal with it, but the Belcher will die, and it's going fairly low. The good thing about going low HP here before armoring up is that the second revenge that he has in his hand will deal that 3 damage, so he could potentially take out more minions than if his life total was high.
Yeah, and that's a pretty reassuring card to draw after you've just face tanked 9 damage, to see that Justicar True Heart appear as your next card.
Absolutely. Amnesiac doesn't really have direct win condition in his hand right now, but the longer the game goes, I think it might even favor him, unless Talion gets the Jaraxxus up fairly soon.
You know, one key thing to point out here is that Talion ended up playing his Emperor Thorsen before he drew his Jaraxxus. So whenever he does end up drawing Jaraxxus, he doesn't get the immediate Infernal. That's a really big deal, and maybe another reason he could have considered holding on to Emperor for longer. We also don't know whether Amnesiac plays the Harrison Jones or not. So if you manage to establish Jaraxxus on a board that's just somewhat empty and just not be threatened of dying to Gromash, you can still just win the game with an endless stream of Infernals if the Warrior doesn't play Harrison.
Absolutely.
So this turn a little bit awkward here from Talion. The only real proactive threat here he has is the Void Caller, but with nothing in hand to pull off it, how proactive is it? But either way, I was going to say, he should probably go ahead and life tap first. Zombie Chow, again, not really what he was looking for, so he may just have to play out the Void Caller here, hope the bluff is not called, but pretty rough situation.
Yeah, the thing is, Amnesiac's already seen Mal'Ganis, he's already seen Doomguard. The only other demons that we played are a second Void Caller, and, well, we already seen the second Void Caller, so he knows.
Sometimes there's Imgang Boss included as well for some extra stability.
Sure, yeah. But Amnesiac would like to get Jaraxxus into play so he doesn't have to deal with it as a hero. Yep. So no matter what, Amnesiac would deal with Void Caller here, I would think. And there is that Harrison.
There's the Harrison that you mentioned, Reynard. So if that Jaraxxus is drawn by Talion and he gets it on the board, it might potentially be a good thing for Amnesiac and not Talion.
Yeah, so the Zombie Chow gonna heal him back up to 16 here, and alongside that Justicar True Heart, the threat of any burst damage from hand is kind of just melted away here. Talion's gonna have to find some way to get back onto this board, and as we've mentioned for pretty much the entire game, his only real way to do that is getting to that Jaraxxus pretty soon.
Yeah, and now Hellfire looking decent here. Hellfire Darkbomb would give him a full clear. No, he can't quite get the Maltness on board just yet. Only 4 cards remaining in Talion's deck right now. Yep, Amnesiac's still with 11.
One of them is Jaraxxus. He knows that he kind of has to play out these Molten Giants before he plays Jaraxxus, because once Jaraxxus is down, you have to get to below 5 life to even be able to cast your Molten Giants.
Right.
So I would not be surprised to see him just deal with his Deathlord before tapping. He's going to do it after tapping. Oh, worked out. He got the BGH out of his deck first.
He's leaving the Deathlord up because he does not want the Jaraxxus to get on the board as a minion. He wants to draw it into his hand
first. Life tap first gave him one more chance to draw that Jaraxxus and be free to kill the Deathlord. And since he didn't get it, he's just going to leave it alive because he knows the game is over if that Jaraxxus Battlecry does not activate.
That's a play from Amnesiac, choosing not to attack. He doesn't want to make it any easier for Talion to play those Molten Giants.
Yeah, he knows the Molten Giants are coming. He knows that Talion has almost no cards remaining, so it's extremely likely that Talion is holding at least one of the Giants. Amnesiac doesn't have a Brawl yet. If he had a Brawl, in that case, maybe attacking would have been a little bit more tempting.
So only 2 cards left in Talion's deck. He knows that Life Tap is going to bring him a lot closer to fatigue, literally getting rid of half the cards in his deck. So he might just opt to, you know, play a Dark Bomb, play a Molten Giant. Definitely want to get those out before this Jaraxxus.
Yeah, seems legit. I'll be interested to see if what minions, if any, are left in the deck at this point. I believe there's an Argus that we haven't seen that we saw at Mulligan. Looks like he's just not. He doesn't want to draw the fatigue card here, but there's no real reason not to do it because he can. Amnesiac can force the draw anyway by just attacking, so I guess he's considering holding onto that Dark Bomb for other utility here, potentially just for final late game damage if he needs it.
Yep. And Talion likely to have. I think it's actually guaranteed to have at least one Defender of Argus in there in his last card, so there is still minions. That Death Roll will be meaningful. Amnesiac thinking about whether or not to attack with the Deathlord again. Or is he thinking about the Tempo Harrison, maybe?
It looked a bit like a face of regret to me, Savitz. I feel like he considered that he should have suicided his Deathlord just so that Talion had one fewer card to work with. But yeah, this is looks like Talion is most likely going to deal with... Well, he didn't deal with Deathlord last turn, right? So maybe this turn he lets it live again. Mm-hmm. It's very risky. I mean, if the Deathlord pulls the Defender Vargas out, not only do you fatigue a turn earlier, but you miss out on that battle cry.
Right.
It's a very important battle cry. It can keep you alive against Grommash.
I kind of believe that that Defender is going to hit the board next turn anyway, because Amnesiac will have the option to trade off his Deathlord to speed up that fatigue from Talion.
Right, but it's an option that he turned down on the previous turn. As Reynard pointed out, he could have cashed in his Deathlord the previous turn, and like Talion would be out of cards this turn. But like you said, still has the opportunity to do it. But if that last card for... Say there were two cards left in deck, one of them was a minion, one of them was a spell. The previous turn for Amnesiac could have been the last chance for him to pull a minion out of the deck with the Deathlord.
I like Talion's choice to not play the Sun Fury this time around. You know that, you know, if your Molten Giant ends up living to make use of that taunt, you're in a decent spot anyway. You don't need this minion in play. It's better to save that battle cry for your Infernals later in the game.
Yeah, if Amnesiac knew that the last card is the Defender of Argus, he would probably pull it out just to like, get rid of that battle cry. But
yes.
Obviously, he does not have access to that information, so he's going to just go face with the Deathlord here.
Right. If the last card is a spell, we're all dumb. But if that last card was the Shadowflame or the Dark Bomb that we see in Talion's hand, then by cashing in his Deathlord, nothing would happen because there's no minions in the deck, and then he just takes 8 to the face from the Molten Giant potentially, or it kills his Elise. So from his perspective, you can see this turn, it's a hell of a lot more risky to try and cash that in.
Yep, so it was a minion, but also another minion with a battle cry. So that battle cry would have not happened, but it would have been able to attack in that case.
Yep, very true.
Talion had the option here to play Jiraxxus, end up meleeing Deathlord with the weapon. He decides to just go for the Dark Bomb instead, hold off on Jiraxxus a little bit more. Had he played the Jiraxxus there, it would have potentially given Amnesiac lethal through Grommash plus Revenge or Grommash plus Slam, because War Axe plus Grommash would have been, you know, 13 damage. He just that two points of life, I feel like really made the difference this turn. He's gonna go for the more defensive play, try to set up Jiraxxus on a board where he won't die to Grom.
Right, exactly. This play is all about just kind of securing his position so he can play Jiraxxus in a non-threatened position. But the Brawl top deck here, even for 10 mana, Amnesiac knows that he has a second one of these left in the deck after this. We saw double Brawl in the Mulligan. So he may just be considering jamming this here to try and just deal with this Molten Giant, and he does.
Yeah, I think it's a no-brainer. The other options seemed all bad, and even if the worst case happens, which is the Molten Giant surviving, he still removed 7 power off the board, but that's certainly not what he wanted to see.
Okay, suddenly we have a game here. There is an AA on board with Taunt protecting this Jiraxxus. I'm sure we won't see anything else but Jiraxxus come down this turn. But the Harrison Jones is the X factor here. Talion might feel like he's in an awesome position, but that Harrison Jones is going to come down and potentially crush some dreams here.
Yes. Harrison Jones actually lets Amnesiac get back into this. He had no way to deal with this Molten Giant. And now, 7 cards deeper in the deck, there's going to be something, I imagine.
Yep. I mean, if second Execute is drawn here, he has the Activator for it, plenty of mana to use it, so Execute could be huge, but his hand just filling up with so many resources here. There's the second Brawl, the map drawn, Shield Slam Bash as well, and he even fatigues himself for 1 at the end. Wow.
So, no Execute. How are we dealing with this Molten Giant? He's got 4 damage from a Shield Slam. He's got a Bash. Not enough mana to really do everything that he wants to do.
No.
Could just play some time with the Deathlord. Maybe even drop the Doomsayer and hope that there's going to be an empty board next turn.
Oh, he's going to face tank it.
Revenge.
Bash. Interesting.
All right. Well, the Giant is gone now. And with that play, the Grommash with an activation would get there, but he no longer has an activation for it.
He has Shield Slam, right?
Right. So if he has even a little bit of armor remaining, because he's going to take some fatigue damage, but I believe he's taking two
fatigue damage. So he'll have 1 armor next turn. Talion has just fatigued for 2, which means 10 damage will be dealt from the Grom. He'll then fatigue for 3, and he will die.
Yeah.
So Talion has no way to prevent that Grom damage. Amnesiac is keeping track of how much fatigue damage Talion's taking every turn. He should have exact lethal no matter what line of play Talion takes here. The light
does not. That's right. Talion going to play that Kazan Mystic. Amnesiac now knows that there's a Kazan in the deck. So going forward here, Talion still will need to find a win with his Warlock. But Amnesiac has pretty much the perfect information what's in the deck. And there's the Grom.
Yep. Amnesiac spots it, no surprise, picks up the Shield Slam, enrages his Grom, 10 damage, and we're going to see the Fatigue draw come out for 3 here, and Amnesiac is going to go to a 1-game lead in the series.
Yeah, those 2 key tech choices from Amnesiac winning the game for him there, the Gore Howl and the Harrison Jones.
Yeah, and you called it right at the start of the matchup. Harrison Jones could be potentially important even before we were entirely clear on what the Warlock archetype was. You said Harrison Jones is going to be huge for that Jiraxxus, and we saw that exact situation happen.
Yeah, it's a bit unintuitive, too. You don't think weapons when you think Warlock, but
right.
that specific matchup, if you play it enough, that's what it comes down to a lot of times.
Absolutely. That game, Harrison Jones was certainly game-winning for Amnesiac. It has some weak matchups, some matchups where Harrison Jones is maybe not that spot-on, but he did ban a non-weapon class from Talion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have had the opportunity to talk to Talion a little bit earlier. We've talked at length about Amnesiac already, but Talion a bit of a lesser-known quantity to us. So let's just take a moment just to get to know Talion a little bit better.
I was playing card games for on and off for 10 years before I ventured into Hearthstone, and since starting Hearthstone, I haven't looked back and have been playing it since. I'm just not very intrigued in what school has to offer at the moment. I think of esports not as a career, but a lifestyle. Being able to travel around, interact with fans, and talk about things that you're truly passionate means a lot to me. So I'd rather be doing something that I really enjoy than to be forced into taking a safe route. My parents aren't super supportive. They're kind of conservative, but I think they just really want what's best for me, and they're not gonna get in my way. If I tell them that I think pursuing career in esports is the best thing for me, I think they will accept that. This tournament is gonna be the most important tournament I've ever played in. It definitely means a lot to me. If I do end up winning this tournament, I do think it's a validation for myself, and I do think I can call myself a professional player at that point. I don't really strive for being the best player in the world. I want to be in the conversation of one of the best players in the world. This tournament is not the end goal. It's just the beginning of the road to the World Championship. To me, that's more meaningful than just finishing a good place. So I'm really risking everything, and I'm here to win. I'm not here to settle. I'm Talion, and I'm going to prove this weekend that hard work really does pay off, and I will win this tournament.
Hugely confident words at the end there from Talion, and some of you at home who may not be too familiar with him will be saying, well, you know, who is this guy? Why is he so confident? I don't know who he is. He's lost game one. He's down in the series. Now, what right does he have to throw those words around? But we've looked into the stats here, and actually just looking at this matchup individually, Talion and Amnesiac have met each other 15 times in ranked play, and Talion has won 11 of them, which is, what, a 73% win rate overall?
That's quite a bit. That's amazing that he has such a great win rate against a player like Amnesiac. Definitely high caliber players both. And wow, that was. If his parents are not like fully behind him on this esports thing just yet, if he was to win here, if he was to qualify the World Championship, that would be huge.
Yeah, definitely go a long way to convincing parents that what we do is legitimate here. But we are going to switch over. Looks like the Rogue has been queued up from Amnesiac. Talion is going to remain with the Control Warlock Handlock, Demon Handlock variant that he was playing. And Reynard, thoughts on this match, Rogue and the Handlock?
Well, this is a matchup that the most important card actually ends up being Blade Flurry. You definitely want to set up a very powerful combination of cards as the Rogue to kind of either deal with a strong board from the Warlock or just kill them outright out of nowhere. I do think that one of the, I guess not 100% immediate clear advantages of winning last game for Amnesiac is the fact that he got to see the entire deck from Talion.
Yes.
So he actually has so much information going into this. He knows exactly what cards to play around. He saw, you know, he saw the Shadow Flame, he saw BGH. He knows specifically what type of Warlock it is, how many of each card. It's, if I had to give the edge to anyone, I'd say the perfect information, I would give it to the Rogue in this case.
And most importantly, just finishing off your thought, like he saw there is no Acidic Ooze. So that's a card that you sometimes see teched into Control Warlocks. And he knows he can sit there and just put his Poison on, put his Tinker Oil on if he's playing that variation, and just sit there, wait with the huge dagger for the potential burst damage or the big clear of multiple giants.
Yeah, personally, I would already slightly lean towards the Rogue when talking about favorites in this matchup. But having access to all that information makes it even better.
He didn't actually see the BGH, it was the last card, but I do think, for most Rogue lists, it doesn't matter unless they play Dr. Boom. You usually
right.
don't have targets anyway. You can kind of assume the Warlock has it. So I saw 29 cards, but can pretty much assume the 30th. Really strong start here from the Warlock, though. You don't have coin, which is actually very good for Handlock. You want to be the one going first.
Right.
And you get to play the turn 4 Mountain Giant, which is the most powerful opening you can have against a deck like Rogue.
Yeah, certainly. It's interesting because some newer players might look at this and say, oh, hang on, he had a 2-drop. You know, he had Dark Peddler that he could play out early. Why hasn't he done that? But he recognizes that the idea here is just to get the big threats out as quickly as possible. And, you know, back in the day, this is how Handlock beat Rogue, just by getting those huge threats down, making them get sapped early on, and then just replaying them when you're under very little pressure. So he's choosing to skip the Dark Peddler early on just to increase the size of his Twilight Drake, and increase the speed at which he can play his Mountain Giant.
Yeah, Dalian choosing to go for the Twilight Drake here instead of the Mountain Giant. He sees that Shredder on the board already, so it's very likely that whatever minion he plays is going to get killed instead of sapped. So having that one extra toughness and maybe that 3-mana Giant for next turn with a life tap can work out slightly better.
He also knows that if his minion ends up living, rather than going face against the Rogue, he'd rather be trading into minions and just kind of buying time to play his slower Warlock cards. Mm-hmm. So one great thing about this when you draw a Twilight Drake and Mountain Giant combination is they curve perfectly into each other. You play a Twilight Drake turn 4, turn 5, you can still life tap again and play Mountain Giant. So great spot to be in for Talion as far as this matchup goes. It's exactly the kind of opening you want.
Yeah, also the Emperor Thorison is absolutely huge because he will get to do it on turn 6 against the Rogue very likely and have a lot of cards going into it. And Amnesiac here finds what he considers to be the best way to deal with this Twilight Drake right now, and going to use that weapon. I believe we're going to see the Pilot Shredder trading into it as well.
Yes. So yeah, he did have a lot of options of ways to clear that. He only needed the 4 damage, obviously, and with 2 Eviscerates in hand, but he chose to go with the line that also let him develop his board with the SI7 agent, maximize the pressure on his opponent, and also put the most damage into play to potentially deal with the next big threat that's being played next turn.
Yep.
Yeah, Loot Hoarder coming out of Shredder is actually a very big deal. Every card from the Rogue is so impactful. You want to get these very specific cards for specific situations, like Sap. You want preparation to go with your Oil and your Flurries, your Sprint. So a lot of the most powerful things Rogue can do involve 3-card combinations, so you'd almost always rather have a card in your hand off of the thing you get off of Shredder, rather than just having like a simple 3-2 in play.
Yeah. Looking at Amnesiac's hand right now, it's even more important to get that one, because he doesn't really have many options for his turn 5 and 6, so that Loot Hoarder hasn't been corrupted yet, pops out of the Shredder as a 2-drop. Is going to double his chances of finding a solid turn 5 play.
I like Talion's option to tap there. It's you know, you're behind on board, you're taking a lot of damage. If you life tap, you take 2 more damage from that hero power. It takes a bit of courage to make the life tap play in this case, but it's definitely correct, I think. And I'm happy to see him make that play.
Yeah, it's kind of a natural curve in Handlock as old as time at this point. Twilight Drake on 4, tap Mountain Giant on 5, but yeah, you do have to be a little bit fearless to keep tapping with this deck sometimes, but he has the security, he has a couple of taunts in hand, anti-killbot in hand as well, so if he knows that if he needs to react to an emergency situation, he has the cards to be able to do that. Just make sure he draws enough proactive threats for the following turns.
Yep. No sap from Amnesiac, so that Mountain Giant is going to stick around, and he actually might not... does he have the opportunity to play the Emperor here? I believe he does, but he could also be looking at the Shadow Flame play here.
So many, yeah, if Talion ends up trading, he's looking at 17 damage from Amnesiac, so he would actually live, and you can't really put Amnesiac on double Eviscerate Blade Flurry.
Right.
That's some of the, like, it's probably like the biggest combination of burst damage he can have, excluding any preparation draw. So, ooh.
Ooh, that's a great card. Yeah.
So yeah, Mortal Coil means he can't play Emperor Thorsen, but he did draw essentially the best 5-drop in his deck in this matchup. Super powerful against Rogue, as we can see, just eliminating all of Amnesiac's options for a turn.
But good news for Amnesiac, with that extra draw from the Loot Hoarder, he did pick up an Azure Drake, so even though he can't play spells here, he has a reasonable minion to play.
Yeah, with that left side of his hand all clogged up with those spells he's had in his hand the entire game, really important that his deck is kind to him and just keeping up the pressure for a couple of extra turns here, because Amnesiac will be hoping that there are no healbots or drawn yet, and he'll be able to just push through with this burst damage. But when the healbot and the defensive lines come down from Talion very shortly, he knows he's going to have to make this game, stretch this game out to several more turns, and he's going to need minions off the top of his deck to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's very risky to just drop a Molten Giant and taunt it up. Unlike most matchups, it's kind of like the most powerful thing the Warlock deck can do. But against Rogue, it makes you very vulnerable to Blade Flurry. So Talion's going to want to clear the board a bit more. Maybe get Amnesiac to use that weapon that's buffed up.
More spell power for Amnesiac.
Yeah, before dropping the Molten. So we'll see what he ends up going with here. But I definitely like his play to kind of control the board more.
Yeah, I was expecting maybe attacking with a low tap into the Shredder and then going for a Shadow Flame on the low tap, but he has a different plan here.
The respect for the spell damage in Rogue, sending an 8 power into a Kobold Geomancer. Possibly the hardest a Kobold Geomancer has ever been hit in this game. Oh, yeah. Wow. Oil.
So Talion did take a very defensive line of play there, but it hurts a lot to miss out on 8 points of face damage just to kill off a 2-drop,
right,
you know?
Exactly.
So by doing that, yes, Talion has essentially like lowered the odds that Amnesiac just kills him on his turn, but the downside is you're making the game last longer. You're giving the Rogue more time to draw into combos, to draw into Blade Flurries. You do need to end the game when you have a board lead at some point with Handlock. So the Shadow Flame play, for example, would have allowed Talion to get 8 damage to the face, and that's a very big deal. So it's a very high opportunity cost to making this line of play that Talion did.
Certainly, but if he did not do that play and there was a minion left on the board, that would have been a decent opportunity for an oil to get that buff going. And here, that is going to be the Blade Flurry that you mentioned, Reynard, as one, potentially one of the key plays in this matchup. He has not seen a big game hunter, but he's still going to play around it, guessing that it's the last card from the previous matchup. And well, it's not in the hand, but Amnesiac is still playing around the potential pitches there.
Yeah, I like that play from Amnesiac a lot. In a lot of cases, there's not too much difference between a 6-6 and an 8-8 minion. But yeah, just eliminating one possible answer Talion can have is a very big deal. The Warlock's drawn a lot of cards at this point. It's very likely he has big game hunter.
Yeah, very true. And just going back to the point earlier, I think playing Handlock aggressively is something that a lot of players do miss out on. I completely agree with you. I would like to have seen some of that damage go to face at some point. Now he's lost his board, hasn't really achieved anything with it in case of progressing the game, because Handlock is a deck where you're playing 8-8 minions incredibly early. And when you're doing that, you're kind of the aggro deck, right? Like, you have the board lead, you need to take the initiative. Now he's lost his board, he's facing down potential lethal from his opponent. He's now probably forced to make a defensive play every turn for a long time now. So when does he find the time to get the initiative back?
And that Shadow Flame also, you're looking kind of worthless in his hand right now. If there was something like a Violet Teacher, maybe spawning some 1-1s, it can help to have access to it, but...
Second oil. We don't usually see that on the Rogue decks. A lot of times it's common to just play 1 as a finisher, but 2 is very, very aggressive. Amnesiac's going to look to draw some preparations for those. I'm just going to go in right now.
How much is that?
Get the option to eviscerate first. For
yeah,
5 more.
He was 2 off with the Abyss, but he's just going to put him to 4 here, having seen 1 Healbot with the Abyss in hand. He has more damage than that with the Tinker's Oil if a taunt doesn't come down as well. So having seen some defensive options used already, he's just going to kind of push all in here. Keeps his 6-6 on board. He's asking for taunt and heal and an answer to this 6-6, all to potentially prevent lethal. And if the worst comes to worst, he can just bail out and use Sprint to refill his hand.
To be honest, the Molten into Charax is not looking too bad here.
And the Molten draw is huge.
Yeah.
Shadow Flame
Healbot looks like what he's going for. So again, just pretty much the most defensive play he could have made this turn.
Yeah. That Edwin just traded for his 0 mana 8-8 and the most powerful AoE out of the Warlock deck. That's pretty good value for a 3-drop.
It's not too bad. And there we go. So as I said, Amnesiac took that one turn essentially for free to just push, see if he could win the game right there. And when it didn't work out, he had that sprint to fall back on to now set up and play the long game again.
Yeah, I really don't like that play last turn from Talion. He had the opportunity to use that Molten Giant to just flip the state of the board so quickly and just be a little bit more aggressive. Instead, he's put himself in a position where he essentially let the Rogue make the first play,
right?
Because all he has is a 3-3 on the board. And Amnesiac took that turn to sprint, so once again, Talion has initiative. But the Rogue is just so many cards into the deck at this point, it's a very real risk that he just ends up getting killed out of nowhere with spells.
Certainly, but that sprint comes at a cost. Amnesiac not able to develop any minions on the board right now, so Talion is going to be able to play that Doctor Boom, and that's certainly a powerful card. Too bad for him that Amnesiac has a BGH already ready and waiting.
Yeah, normally this is a card that gives Rogue some nightmares. Dealing with Doctor Boom, one of the hardest things possible. But yeah, he's interesting. More coiling his own Boombot there, and also not the Boombot that would allow him to taunt up the two largest things.
I don't mind Mortal Coiling your own Boombot. I think it's definitely a solid play. You do want to get use out of that coil, get a little bit deeper into the deck. But yeah, I would have liked to see him Mortal Coil the minion in the middle, the Boombot, and then be able to taunt up the bigger minion, right? Like, if you're fine with the Rogue attacking your Dr. Boom.
It certainly is a little bit surprising, but he wants the Rogue to attack that Boombot for some reason, or Was he maybe a little bit playing too quickly there? Not sure.
He may also just be trying to protect from like a second Blade Flurry so he can't hit the boom first. But like this is all kind of weird niche things. We're trying to find an explanation. But yeah, it seems kind of strange the decision to Mortal Coil the rightmost boom bot instead of the one that was interrupting his Sun Fury.
Yeah, worth pointing out, Mijak does play Big Game Hunter in his rogue deck. It is pretty uncommon, just like the two oils. So this is very much not a rogue deck that's anti-aggro. It's more trying to do well against the slower decks in the metagame.
That Big Game Hunter certainly worked out well here, being able to deal with that Dr. Boom very easily.
Absolutely. So he's got some options here as far as Emperor Thorsen or Jiraxxus. A lot of lines of play. I think Jiraxxus is just... You're too far behind on board to be able to play that at this point. You just run the risk of dying. So I think I would like to see maybe an Emperor Thorsen plus some 2-drops. But Talion has so many options to consider, right? He's thinking, if I play Peddler, what could I get off of that? If I Life Tap, what cards are left in my deck? And all these kinds of things are the thoughts going through your head when you're playing a tournament at this level.
Right. Not only is he considering all those things, it's like I have the chance to hit multiple outs potentially from the Peddler, also from the Life Tap. What's the correct order to do it in? How much mana do I need to leave open for each of these options? So decides to go for the Peddler first here. Yep. And there's a lot of potentially good cards here that can have utility. Mortal Coil doesn't quite have an immediate effect here, but it's gonna Doomguard. Gets rid of the Emperor and the Big Game Hunter, still keeps that Jiraxxus in hand. But honestly, maybe just took the Peddler card there, hoping that it would be one of the cards discarded, because the rest of his hand had a pretty solid utility.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he was looking for cards like Abusive Surge and Power Overwhelming to help out with the trades there. But Mortal Coil, not too bad if you get to cycle it.
Yeah, so Talion opts not to play the Sun Fury or Life Tap. Mm-hmm. He recognizes that if he goes 2 life lower, he is... increases the odds that he does just die from Amnesiac's burst damage. And he wants to make sure he can play this Jiraxxus at some point this game. I'm ready
to learn. Yeah, so first Violet Teacher of the game is going to come down here. Does have the backstab and the Fan of Knives. Dagger Hit can come into the 3-1 anti-killbot and clear that out. And he has the option to use the Eviscerate here to take down the Doomguard as well if he would like to, and does.
Yeah, that's going to be a full clear. He can use the weapon to finish up that heal, but...
This is just the power of Violet Teacher in Rogue. This is one of the only decks in the game that still uses this minion, and it's just so incredibly powerful here. 4 mana, 3-5, you made 3-1-1s immediately. You're threatening to make more if it survives.
Yeah, it's a classic set minion that was seen in Druid for a while in combination with Power of the Wild, but for the most part has kind of been rotated out as more options came in that fit people's game plans better. But as you mentioned, Rogue just sticks with it. Just so many cheap spells in the deck, backstabs, preparations. It's able to refill a board and seize tempo on huge turns. Really important in some matchups. Violet Teacher prep sap, for example, is huge against Druid.
I am a fan of temp. I am a fan of tempo, so. Kazan Mystic also, interesting tech choice here in the Warlock, right? I don't usually see cards like that in Warlock decks, but it does help with otherwise almost unwinnable matchups like Freeze Mage.
Freeze Mage, right. Yeah, it's something I've seen in people's tournament lineups in some recent tournaments that I've cast. I think it's been more common in Reno Lock, for example, than not to have the Kazan Mystic in there because Freeze Mage is so popular at the moment in the tournament format.
Well, let's see where the oil goes. I believe that's going to be lethal if he gets on one of the minions that's already on the board, but unfortunately... unfortunately he gets it on a minion that was just played, so... Amnesiac not able to end the game just yet, but things are still looking very good for him.
Yep, definitely one of the drawbacks of Violet Teacher and Rogue is the unfortunate synergy with Tinker's Oil. But, yeah, still very strong here. Just an almost insurmountable board. He already knows that Shadow Flame's out of the Warlock deck. He knows that Talion most likely only plays one because he saw 29 of his cards.
Yep.
And he knows that if Talion plays Hellfire, he kills himself. So no need to worry about AoE here. Just kind of extend onto the board as much power as possible and try to end the game next turn.
Yeah, Talion, looking at his last turn of game two, goes for the concede.
Yeah, so conceded by Talion, Amnesiac, backing up his confidence. Talion so far failing to do so, but 2-0 lead from Amnesiac so far. Huge lead, and not insurmountable. We saw a comeback begun by Chucky in the previous series, but in Conquest particular, how big of a deal is it to be 2-0 behind? Obviously it's bad, but how terrible is it?
Well, I mean, it's really big, and Amnesiac's last deck is going to be a Paladin. It could be a Murloc Paladin, but most likely it's going to be a Secret Paladin, and there's some good matchups there. Especially the Warrior from Talion, also the Warlock, not too bad. The Mage is going to be an uphill battle, but Amnesiac will have 3 chances to find the win with the Paladin.
Right. Even if you're unfavored in all three of your matchups, because of the way Hearthstone percentages work, normally you're something like 45% unfavored. So if you're 2-0 up in a series and you have three 45% unfavored matchups, you're still favored to win the series. You're going to win one of those on average. So.
Yeah. And that, I have to say that that Warlock might be a little bit difficult for the for the Paladin. I mean, just think it doesn't really matter if you play Secret Paladin.
Because honestly, it doesn't seem too impactful, right? Because you're stealing one mana secrets. But a lot of times it is the difference between winning or losing a game. Because Avenge, the +2 health buff on that can get your minions out of range of things like Hellfire. So Kazan Mystic can kind of help you swing boards you otherwise can't. There's other board states where if your opponent has like Piloted Shredder plus a secret and you manage to steal a Noble Sacrifice from them, that can completely swing the game as well. So Kazan Mystic is definitely going to help him in the Paladin matchup, at least I think. But yeah, that is not the deck you want to face when you're down 2-0. Paladin definitely a deck that's known for. It does have some less than favorable matchups, but those matchups are still not that bad, right? You still have like a 45% chance of winning, like you mentioned. So
right. And remember, if you want to get involved in the conversation, perhaps throw some more shameless praise at Reynard, as we just saw on the screen there, you can use the hashtag HCT and possibly get your tweets featured on stream, as we just saw. But yeah, Paladin, as we mentioned, Mage, I mean, Paladin is a deck that we've heard does poorly against Freeze Mage in general, but in real-world terms, where we've seen it on stream, particularly in the preliminaries, the Paladin actually did pretty well, primarily because of extra tech choices that people were bringing, like Iron Beak Owl that was lining up against Doomsayers. Lotheb as well can be a huge deal, as it is for any deck against Freeze Mage.
Is there any chance that Mage would be something else than a Freeze Mage? Because we actually don't have like the information.
No, of course.
There's no guarantee that it would be a Freeze.
Oh, never mind.
Doomsayer from Amnesia.
Anything, my friends, can
anything
happen.
Anything can happen in this game.
Yeah, so this is... This is actually one of my favorite decks to play on ladder recently. The Murloc Paladin deck, unlike the Seeker Paladin deck, actually has very polarizing matchups.
Yes.
It's a lot of, you know, 90-10 matchups.
Right.
One way or the other. You know, if you're playing against Aggro Shaman, you basically can't win. But if you're playing against something like Freeze Mage, or in this case, Handlock, you basically can't lose, in my opinion. I actually think this matchup is abysmal for Talion. I expect a 3-0 sweep here.
Like, yeah, that Kazan Mystic not going to help out at all. I think it's still a smart choice from Talion to go with the Warlock deck again, because he will have to win with all three of his decks. And going further, even if he drops down to the lower bracket, he can keep his other decks a secret so that his future opponent won't have the information.
Right. It's not the best for building up the drama of the series, but I have to say I do completely agree with Reynard. Slow decks in general, if you give Anyfin Paladin a chance to draw through their deck, play their Murlocs, and draw both Anyfins, pretty much no deck in the game can stop that. So the decks that beat it are the decks that operate too quickly to allow that to happen.
Yep, it's not the first Anyfin that gets you, but the second one is usually hitting you for upwards of 40 damage.
Yes,
so it's
correct.
Tough to recover from. But yeah, one of the reasons that the Paladin deck is so strong against the slower decks is because it has all these answers for the threats that Talion will be presenting. It has things like Eldor Peacekeeper, which can just neutralize massive minions very easily. Doomsayer can kind of slow down the turn 4 play from Talion in some cases. Interesting play from Amnesiac here. Most of the time, Talion's just going to be life tapping turn 2, so I'm surprised to see him drop that there.
Right. It's not even, like, people call when a Doomsayer is just played onto the board, it's usually referred to as a tempo Doomsayer, but this really doesn't even deny any tempo from your opponent because their plan was probably just going to be to life tap anyway. So the situation is pretty much the same thing minus a Zombie Chow, which isn't really a big deal. Does let him develop a 3-3 onto an empty board here, but the early board lead is not going to be the important thing in this matchup.
Yeah, I wouldn't have hated waiting one turn with that to kind of counter the potential coin Twilight Trick or coin Void Caller play. Because that would have been not so successful against the Doomsayer. But he does go for it, and that allows him to play the 3-3 Murloc on an empty board and getting the early control.
So one of the key strategies from the Warlock deck in most matchups would be to, you know, drop a bunch of Molten Giants, one or two of them later in the game when you're falling behind, give them taunt immediately, and all of a sudden be ahead on board even though your life total's low, and then follow that up with some healing and finishing off the game. The reason that doesn't work out so well against the Murloc version of the Paladin class is because equality is kind of the core piece of this deck. That's the way you win games. You use equality with Wild Pyromancer that Amnesiac just drew to kind of eliminate everything on the board, follow that up with maybe a Solemn Vigil, draw some cards. It's very, very powerful effect that we only see in this version of Paladin.
Yeah, Amnesiac playing the True Silver Champion. Because of the drawn out game one, he has the information that Talion is not running at the Acidic Swampoos. Perfectly safe there.
Yeah, like you say, equality is key to this matchup and so many matchups in general with Anyfin Paladin. Players that I've spoken to who play this deck at an extremely high level basically say they keep equality in almost every matchup in their opening hand because it's just so core to the deck strategy to have those huge board clears. Not only can they relieve pressure, but they also open up huge swings in terms of card draw with Solemn Vigil as well.
Yeah. Speaking of card draw, Amnesiac right now doesn't have any, and he certainly would love to draw some from the top.
Yeah, he's only one war leader through the eventual process of getting his Murlocs out there. I guess we should explain the overall strategy of this deck cause to people that haven't really grasped it. You have five Murlocs in your deck, two Bluegill Warriors, two Murloc War Leaders, and an old Murkai. The idea is just to play those cards out at some point, have them die, and then the card Anyfin Can Happen revives them all at the same time to create a huge amount of burst damage.
Yeah, and the first Anyfin, like Reyna mentioned a little bit earlier, does not deal necessarily that much damage, but the second one is pretty much guaranteed to pull out a full board of Murlocs, and each one of them will either be buffing or charging, and that adds up to crazy amounts of damage.
Yep, some people might be wondering why, you know, Amnesiac is holding on his Wild Pyromancer, and it kind of comes from the main way you're trying to play the Paladin deck. Your big picture strategy is to clear the board of equality at some point, so you never want to be left without some enabler for equality. So when you have just Pyromancer, you basically can't play it until you draw a Consecrate, and then you can play one of the two. Just so you always have an enabler for it. It's a very key way of how to play the deck. But yeah, Emperor Thorsten is going to get dropped here. Very easy onboard answer for Amnesiac, and he just can't be happier to have this matchup.
I mean, the matchup is great, but the hand is abysmal. No Lay on Hands for next turn. Still no Acolytes of Pain. No, what is that? Solemn Vigil.
Solemn Vigil?
Yeah, no Solemn Vigils. Nothing that would draw more cards. So he's looking a little bit frustrated right now. If, let's say, his next four draws are still no more card draw, he might be in trouble. Especially since Thalion has that Dr. Boom and the Molten Giant as potential threats.
Yeah. Right. I mean, if the next few turns from Talion are spent playing big threats, then Amnesiac does have the opportunity to spend his turns answering those. He has an Aldor to potentially neutralize a Dr. Boom, so that's one turn that he can deal with. And if, you know, an equality is drawn, that gives him another out as something to do later on if the threats keep coming. But like you said, so key to this deck is the card draw. You really do want to be Lay on Handsing on turn 8 a lot of the time, even if it has no healing effect. It's generally not considered a healing card in this deck. It's just cycle. Right. You just need to get through your deck.
Yeah, second Sludge Belcher for Amnesiac. We don't usually see two of them in this list, so I'm interested to see kind of what he's changed up from the traditional list that we do see on ranked play. But yeah, this is definitely kind of a rough spot for Amnesiac compared to how it normally plays out. He's playing his only answer for big minion right now, and Talion has the Iron Beak Owl in hand to silence his own Dr. Boom, get it back up to 7 attack, and just kind of neutralize that Aldor. Then Amnesiac's kind of left just digging for an equality, but even when he finds it, Talion's going to have more threats.
That's right. And the Wild Pyromancer, even though it goes so well with so many cards, it combos off nicely with the spells. Mm. It just simply doesn't have anything to play with it right now.
Yeah, like, Iron Beacon Owl can be used here to silence the Dr. Boom back to a 7-7. Savitz, just, you know this deck plays Doomsayers, you've already seen one, but in general, how much consideration do you have to silencing Doomsayers in matchups that aren't Freeze Mage, where they don't lock out your board at the same time as they play Doomsayers?
Yeah, I actually think that you can much more easily afford to spend the Owl on your minion, like the Dr. Boom, for example, here, just to keep up with the pressure. There are other ways to deal with the Doomsayer. Most importantly, just to kill it off, use your minions because, like you mentioned, no freeze effects coming in. So I would kind of like to see the Owl here, but I wouldn't also blame him if he chose not to.
Looks like that is what's going to happen. Silences off the Humility effect, sets him back to a 7-7, able to clean out this Sludge Belcher nice and cleanly. But my question here is now, how is he committing the rest of his mana this turn? Because he chose not to tap, so it looks like Dart Bomb's being used, and then we're just going to see the Void Cooler come down.
Yeah, not a bad play.
Ooh.
Well,
not exactly what he wanted from that Boombot, but still a great spot to be in for Talion.
Yeah, what was a bad play, Reynard, is choosing to roll one damage on that Boombot.
Right. Would not recommend that for the viewers at home. Should you try out Warlock? But yeah, just gonna taunt up the Owl, just trying to preserve this Dr. Boom. Doesn't want to give Amnesiac an easy way to trade into it.
I'm a huge fan of this taunt right here.
Yeah, me too, actually.
Amnesiac with 4 power on the board, so if he taunted anything else, those minions could have easily traded for one of the minions. But now that the Owl is going to get the trade instead.
Yeah, Amnesiac knows that his deck plays a lot of healing effects, and Warlock doesn't really have too many burst effects. He's got a lot of life to play with, doesn't feel too bad just hitting a Dr. Boom straight on with his weapon. Now I was just debating, you know, do I play this Doomsayer right now?
Right.
For tempo? Reporting for duty. I think I'd like to see it. The hand doesn't have too much else going on for it.
That's true. Just gonna drop it there. It's not spectacular, but it should slow down Talion a little bit. And we see it here. Talion did pick up that Mountain Giant, so if the Doomsayer was not played, Talion would have been able to get more minions on the board.
Yeah, he's got the option to play Doomguard and kill that off, but I think it's a little ambitious. Just let it blow up, let Doomguard come into play, and yeah, and just hold on to the Peddler as well. Save that 2-2 for next turn. Yeah.
Right. Has the option to invest that 2 mana into the Peddler now if he wants to try and pick up a card, but the Peddler has use as a 2-2, so there's no reason just to invest it onto the board. Anything can happen is now playable, but only one War Leader is inside it right now, which is about as underwhelming as it gets. Yeah. So Hero Power Pass comes out here from Amnesiac, and still, I believe not a single card draw card has been played this entire game from Amnesiac.
So Talion's aware that Amnesiac just passed with 10 mana available, yeah, 3 cards in hand. He knows that none of them can be draw cards because Amnesiac would have played them.
Yep.
He knows none of them are Murlocs because Amnesiac would have played them, and that really telegraphs this equality play clearly. So I don't expect Talion to just run out another big threat. He's going to make Amnesiac have kind of a weak equality because he knows that card's in his hand.
Right, yeah. And also since he, as you said, he can get the read that there is an equality combo in hand and also the read that there is no card draw, he can know once he forces this equality to be used, Amnesiac's kind of completely out of stuff. So I'm really surprised actually to see this extra Mountain Giant even committed towards the board.
I like it. It does kind of threaten lethal right there. Woo. And you gotta get the equality combo out of the way at some point anyway. There's more Molten Giants coming and there's the Mal'Ganis, so he will be able to add more threats.
Right, I mean, my argument here would be that he showed you no way of dealing with that Doomguard, so how many more turns can he sit with just that Doomguard in play before he has to equality it? Just play the Peddler, just develop some small threats alongside it. Right. But he does still have plenty of gas in his hand with those two Molten Giants he can start developing sometime soon. But now with the second War Leader, we're only one or two Bluegill Warriors away from being able to threaten lethal back the other side.
Yeah, Hellfire Assault draw here. Talion can get that out of his hand, clear the board, play a Molten Giant on an empty board, and he knows Amnesiac only has one hand. He's already seen Amnesiac play an Aldor, play an Equality. He didn't have a great answer for Doomguard right away, so
right,
it's very likely that this Molten Giant puts in a lot of work. And
yeah, he has an option to cycle the Mortal Coil here, because after Hellfire, the Molten Giant is going to go down to 5 mana, so if he wants to replace the Mortal Coil, he could. So
many. It's a very good point. Looks like Talion is going to choose not to do that, just leading out with the Hellfire here. Going to Molten Giant for 5 mana, and as you said, 8-8 now on the board against nothing from Amnesiac. He's going to need some help very quickly. That looked like a quality. Oh. It was, yeah. Just going to choose to anything for the double War Leader, which does give him some board presence. It does put him pretty close to just threatening lethal, but...
Amnesiac's going to attack face so that he doesn't die to any 4 damage buff.
Oh man, that's so underwhelming with anything. A little bit unfortunate for Amnesiac not to have drawn a single charger.
Well, this is... I think I would like to see a Molten Giant Shadowflame Anti-Healbot here, but Talion's definitely considering his Mal'Ganis play. He's got a lot of lions here. He can trade with his Molten Giant. Right now, he understands that Amnesiac's in a bad spot, and as the Warlock, you kind of want to capitalize on these situations.
Right.
So again, Molten Giant's really, really big, Sottle, for example, right?
Yes.
So you want to attack
it
with it in the face to end the game quickly. if you constantly end up trading off, you just kind of give the Paladin time to, you know, draw a second Anyfin or draw more Murlocs, draw more card draw. You definitely want to, I think, end the game quickly when you have the Paladin in a position like this.
Agreed. This is a situation we saw him pass up earlier, and we both agreed that we'd like to see it go face. He chose to use the minions in play to clear as opposed to using the Shadow Flame to allow his minions to go face. This time, though, he is going to see the Shadow... Whoa.
Yeah, this is a better
like
line.
Yeah.
See him solid. Let's see if he picks up another Peddler.
So yeah, great turn from Talion. Really like how he played that.
Ooh.
Amnesiac picks up the Equality Enabler. It's going to let him stay alive for another turn. But definitely does not put him in a winning position. He's left with no cards in hand.
Yeah, only 6 life.
Even 3 War Leaders are dead right now, and there's a 4th one on the board. But even a second Anyfin drawn has no real effect on the game because no Charge Murlocs have been drawn yet. So all those buffs from the War Leaders are pretty much wasted in terms of burst damage.
Well, if Talion did play Mal'Ganis and Amnesiac did play a Anyfin, he could trade into it.
Yeah. How many War Leaders? He would have 5 War Leaders on the board.
I think plus three, right?
So he'd have four. Yeah, there's four. There's, yeah, this is the fourth one that's been played total. But still,
oh right,
alive.
Yeah, yeah. But, yeah.
Hey, a card that draws cards.
Right,
what do you
time.
Know?
Yeah, pretty unfortunate draw from Amnesiac to not get it until this point of the game. But yeah, he's just gonna trade in that soldier, make Solemn Vigil cost one less.
Oh, no.
He's very upset about this loss, as he should be. This matchup is so heavily favored towards the Paladin, and yeah, I mean, props to Talion for playing that well. He needed that win. That's the matchup he needed to get lucky if he's going to make it back in the series and mount a comeback.
It very much is, and you know, we both evangelized at the start how easy that matchup should be for the Anyfin Paladin, but just to elaborate, the card draw cards in that deck, two Acolyte of Pains, two Solemn Vigils, two Lay on Hands most of the time at a bare minimum. I didn't hit any of them throughout the entire mid-game, found himself way too low on resources. On top of that, the other way you can win with that deck is if you don't draw that much card draw, you just draw enough Murlocs to get the job done. He didn't get that draw either. He just kind of drew all his removal, had to ration it out one by one. More threats kept coming down. He just found himself behind the whole game. So he's going to have to now line up this Anyfin Paladin against either the Mage or the Warrior of Talion.
Yeah, the card draw, like for every single combo deck, extremely important. Reynard, you pointed out the second slot Peltzer. Do you think there's a chance that Amnesiac maybe took out one of the card draw cards for that one?
Yeah, I mean, one of the flex slots in the deck is Acolyte of Pain. That's a card we see most people include, but some people choose not to. So, I mean, he might have, if that's the card he cut, that's kind of him getting punished for it.
Right.
But again, we don't know. There's so many different ways to build the deck. It's kind of still unexplored, not too common, as powerful as it is. And I'm excited to see more of the deck and kind of see how it plays out.
It reminds me of the early days of Patron Warrior very much, where we all like recognize this is a potentially really powerful strategy, but everyone was kind of messing around with the deck, trying to work out the optimal build. I feel like when someone finally nails down Anyfin Paladin, it's going to be an incredibly powerful thing. But we, as Amnesiac starts to make his final effort to push for this series, you can have a say at home using the hashtag HCT and hashtagging either of these players that you think is going to win. But if you're Talion here, Savitz, what do you queue up next?
I don't think it really matters.
Okay.
Maybe if there's some surprises in one of the decks, you would keep that deck for last. Try to like keep the surprise factor for later on in the winner's bracket or in the loser's bracket if it ends up losing, because both decks have to win, so it doesn't matter. So just try to hide the information from one of the decks. So choose the deck that you want to hide information from.
And you asked the question earlier, Savitz, could this perhaps not be a freeze mage, in fact be something different from Talion? It looks like it is a tempo mage, that pushes the curve a little bit higher with that extra Ragnaros the Fire Lord as well.
Yeah, it looks like Amnesiac does in fact play Acolyte. But yeah, for Talion here, it's such a big deal that this is tempo mage. Such a big deal. Because if this was freeze mage, that matchup is legitimately 90% favored for Paladin. So this definitely gives Talion a solid chance. In a lot of cases, the Murloc Paladin deck has trouble dealing with minions like Piloted Shredder.
Right.
So you can definitely get a nice early lead. Never make your board too vulnerable to equality. Keep a constant stream of threats with card draw like Arcane Intellect, Azure Drake. I would actually favor the Tempo Mage in this matchup.
Yeah, I think that Tempo Mage has a good matchup here. Definitely better than the Freeze Mage would have been, like you mentioned, mostly because of the amount of healing effects in that Paladin. Having the double anti-heal, but double Lay on Hands, it can't be too much for the Mage to deal with.
Yeah, very much so. Looking at the opening hands here, Amnesiac is going to kind of look for... The Paladin cards kind of line up a little bit awkwardly because things like Outdoor Peacekeepers, which are often your early neutralization against mid-range minions, the mid-range minions in Tempo Mage, they kind of have persistent effects while they're on the board, right? Like Flame Waker, Mana Worm, etc. You can't just send those things down to one HP or one attack because their true power is what they do while they're in play when spells are cast.
Oh, one turn late for that Mana Worm. Talion would love to have that for turn one, but now he's going to have to wait a little bit longer with it.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot of really cool tech choices here from Talion. He's opting to play Water Elemental instead of the Shredder that we usually see. Very heads-up choice. Great against weapon classes like Paladin. He has Duplicate as well, which is kind of an uncommon secret. In some cases, you can play it in place of an Arcane Intellect to give you another way to keep the resources flowing throughout the mid-game. But definitely a card that I don't expect Amnesiak will expect from his mage opponent.
Savitz, you're laughing here. I assume at the Sylphin Spirit Walker, which is kind of a crazy outcome of the unstable ball. Yeah, why don't you tell us?
It certainly is, because Amnesiak is playing the Murloc Paladin. So even though Talion is going to be the one playing that Sylphin, it's going to be included in that potential potential Anyfin. And what if the Sylphin gets duplicated? There's like multiple Sylphins. Maybe Talion can go for some sort of mill strategy.
Right, you can fill your opponent's Murloc pool with Sylphin Spirit Walkers that have no impact on the combo. There's also the fact that Murloc buffs are symmetrical, so Murloc War Leaders will in fact buff this Sylphin Spirit Walker on the board if that interaction happens. So it's actually a potentially pretty impactful unstable portal early in the game.
Like, surprising things could happen. It's not the greatest card to get from that, but it's not weak either. It has a decent stat line at 2 and 4. 2 and 5, sorry.
And Talion definitely has the option to play it this turn. Let's see if he goes for that or just the Azure Drake. I'd like to see this Water Immortal come down and just kind of start seeing Amnesiac locked out of weapons. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense to me. No real need to ping this Murkai this turn. And the one way it could be protected from the ping next turn is if a War Leader comes down, but then you have the tools to potentially deal with the War Leader anyway. It would function as a small heal for it, so it can't be pinged out, but seems kind of unnecessary to ping out this turn since it's frozen anyway. So just goes ahead and develops with his full mana here, uses the Azure Drake.
Yeah, Ragnar's the Fire Lord getting picked up, and that's certainly an excellent card in this matchup. Getting that immediate 8 power on the board, and it can even force equalities on its own, even if there's not that many other minions on the play.
Right, it's another one of those minions that you can't just neutralize with an Aldor Peacekeeper or a Humility. It's a thing that has a persistent effect on the board. It's the same kind of thing that bothers Freeze Mage. Just minions that you can't just neutralize with freeze effects, or in this case, by lowering their attack. Minions that you just have to deal with because the persistent effects will crush you if they're allowed to survive.
Fireball pickup is huge here for Talion. It's going to allow him to, well, if he wants to, preserve his Azure Drake, preserve the tempo in the match. Doomsayer is just such a powerful card for the Paladin. It's actually one of the better tools in this matchup.
Right.
A lot of times the mage will start off with something like a Mad Scientist, pull out Mirror Entity, which tends to be the secret that's in common across all tempo mage decks, and then you can just play Doomsayer into a Mirror Entity, give them the Doomsayer, and just blow up their board. But Amnesiac recognizes it's a pretty good turn to play it. You know, even if Talion does end up fireballing it, he's only left with a one power Drake. Pretty good turn to just end up developing it with or without the Mirror Entity synergy.
Yeah, I think if it goes off here, it's going to put him in a really great spot because of the way that Doomsayer and Solemn Vigil line up. The turn is passed back to you, your Doomsayer goes off, and then Solemn Vigil counts all those minions as dying on your turn to discount it. So for that reason, I would love to see this line here.
Amnesiac looking extremely surprised by that play. The Fireball coming down, he did not expect it. He thought that it was more likely that Doomsayer would have just went off, and Talion did spend that Fireball to protect his Drake now.
I'm kind of surprised that Amnesiac is that surprised that it was Fireballed, because I'm sure Talion understands how powerful like one mana, zero mana Solemn Vigil is in this deck, and if you allow a Doomsayer to go off, that's what happens more often than not.
So. I'm actually an expert in that expression. That was not surprise, that was saltiness, because that Fireball is off the top.
Ah, sorry. Reynard, I knew we had you here for a reason. Shining through with your expert analysis on salt. Thank you so much.
Anytime, man, I got you.
Yep.
So yeah, some solid Flame Waker, Flame Cannon line of play here. He could go for the Flame Waker. All right, so the key here is Talion's going to have to spend 2 mana pinging if that misses, but he does get the hit. Very big deal. So yeah, he has the choice of playing that Murloc or the Sorcerer's Apprentice. Pretty good Sorcerer's Apprentice. You don't want to overload this turn for that Ragnaros.
Yeah, continues to hold on to this Spirit Walker, and I'm sure Amnesiac is aware of the fact that that unstable portal card is still in hand for his opponent. So if you're Amnesiac, what kind of thing are you putting your opponent on as that portal card at this point?
Maybe some more burn spells. There could be a second Fireball, for example. Some slow cards, Dr. Boom.
And I mean, but, specifically, he will know that the unstable portal minion is still in hand. So
right,
what are you thinking as Amnesia?
Yeah, it should be something either expensive or situational.
Right.
Maybe it could be a Doomsayer, for example, or
sure.
Or something really huge. What about Deathwing?
Yeah, just suddenly Deathwing. Why not?
Talion has the option to just slam Ragnaros on an empty board, hit him for 8, but it looks like he's leaning towards the duplicate Water Elemental line of play instead. I mean, both plays develop your board pretty well, but it's very tempting to drop Ragnaros on a turn where you know it's going face. And a lot of times when you play against Paladin, any version of Paladin, they're going to have those tokens from their hero power, and Ragnaros runs the risk of hitting those. So when you don't have the 2 mana to commit to pinging those off, a lot of times it's... it's awkward to play Rag later in the game.
Yeah, I would have even hesitate there to play the Rag. I think it's an excellent turn for it because of the potential lay on hands, but on the other hand, maybe this play makes the lay on hands a little bit weaker since it's not healing for a full potential.
Yeah, yeah, I mean,
there it is.
So let's say the equality doesn't happen here. Then you don't really want to play a Ragnaros, right? Because then you're kind of overextending into the equality clear.
Yeah, because next turn is going to be weird after that. I would imagine that it's going to be delayed still, but... Oh, he's going for an Alder Peacekeeper.
So he's going to try and neutralize the board a little bit here. I'm with Savitz, so I would have liked to see the lay on hands. You're only taking 7 damage on board, so you'll push down to 23 next turn.
Yeah.
And this, by the way, that weird interaction that you mentioned, Sottle. If Amnesiac was to play the Murloc War Leader here, it would have buffed one of Talion's minions.
So Amnesiac's wanting to drop the Acolyte this turn because it's going to get 2 cards, essentially. You know, if Talion doesn't have the burn spell to take it off the board, none of the minions on his side of the table have 3 or more attacks. So Amnesiac right now, he just wants to draw cards, not necessarily through lay on hands, but through the minions he has available, and then use the lay on hands later when he gets full value out of the heal.
Yeah, it makes some sense. Talion has a problem to address here as to how he wants to deal with this board. Doesn't really want to start sending off Flamewaker missiles randomly here with the Acolyte in play, so might have to decide how he's dealing with things first. That duplicate can start to get some work done. This might be his long-term play, which is kind of play out the rest of his hand first and then be left with like duplicate Ragnaros as a final checkmate. But that is going to involve him kind of getting rid of some of this board here first, and it looks like he's just going to choose to... ignore the Acolyte for now, let it do its business and deal with it when he can.
Yeah, doesn't want to drop the duplicate and risk that Flamewaker drawing cards for Amnesiac by hitting Acolyte. Second land hands picked up, it's a very big deal. The card's exceptionally powerful in this matchup because a lot of times the Tempo Mage deck can't present more than 8 points worth of power on the board because it doesn't play too many minions. So, yeah, a lot of times you just negate a whole turn worth of attacks, draw 3, and threaten the equality combo the turn after.
Here we go, the lay on hands does happen. No equality, no Wild Pyromancer. So there's no board clear in sight for Amnesiac. He does, however, pick up some other great cards, like the Belcher Healbot, to make the game go a little bit longer. Bolt anything's in his hand already, so if he finds the time to play those, the game should end. As of right now, I believe only Murkai is in the Murloc pool, though. I don't think... Again, he's just whiffed on that early draw of Murlocs. I don't think we saw any Bluegills early on.
I believe he did play one.
Okay, yeah. So a Bluegill and a Murkai.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that's not too much. But he does have the War Leader, but needs to first deal with the...
deal with the Sylphin. Yeah.
I can't believe I'm actually saying that, but... Yeah, he does have to.
Well, interesting choice on whether or not to play Duplicate this turn. It does use the mana pretty well if he wants to do that along with Rag, but... Talion recognizes Amnesiac just drew a bunch of cards and kind of expect the equality clear next turn.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So he's thinking of ways not to overextend. Duplicate and Dr. Boom do not have the best synergy. Because when you kill a Boom Bot, it's not exactly the card you want to duplicate.
Right.
But Ragnaros and Duplicate, on the other hand, if he's the only minion on board, is super powerful.
Yeah, we can see that the Rag would be amazing here, but Talion might be worried about that equality clear and just not play more stuff. Going for Dr. Boom.
Still very strong, a ton of pressure. Even though they might play out kind of similarly in some cases, Murloc Paladin and Freeze Mage, the Paladin deck doesn't actually have access to tools like Frost Nova to negate a turn. They have to rely on healing to kind of negate attacks.
Right.
So, like, having a full board is actually not bad at all for Talion. It's very valuable in this case, where Amnesiac just doesn't have that equality to deal with it.
Yeah, picks up the Pyromancer, so he does at least have the Activator now, but still short that quality that he needs. Gonna go with the Belcher here just to try and reduce some damage for a turn, but with the Boombots in play, that Belcher might not even put up too much of a resistance.
Yeah, this game might very well be coming down to whether or not Amnesia gets the equality on his next draw.
Arcane Intellect's an excellent pickup for Talion. It's gonna give him a Flamewaker trigger, just give him more business in his hand to deal with, and we'll see. Ooh.
Counterspell.
Wow. So Counterspell Duplicate. Very unexpected secret.
Such a great card in this situation.
Yeah, Counterspell, huge against this particular deck. Not only can you block those huge equality clears that we've talked about are so important, but you can also block the potential anything if the game has progressed to the point where they're threatening to kill you with the burst damage. So Counterspell, a really excellent choice to have in this particular state, even though, as Reynard said, the makeup of Duplicate and Counterspell is a little bit unusual.
I don't love that trade. He could have pinged the slime first and gotten more damage on average to the face, but he is going to choose to hold on to the secret. He has to play it, right? The counterspell at this point.
I certainly would.
Just don't see any reason why he wouldn't.
Playmaker too.
So yeah, he could have played that. He could have played that before trading with Boombot and maybe killed the slime, but
right.
Not a huge deal. Still gets it down. Still a dominant board position here from Talion.
So Amnesiac crosses his fingers here, hopes that his opponent played Mirror Entity there, which honestly would have been a mistake to play Mirror Entity when you're that far ahead. Amnesiac just hoping that it happened, gets the bad news that it has not, and he realizes he's in serious trouble here, sees no way out, concedes the game, and Talion squares it back up. 2-2, starting to fight his way back, but his remaining deck now is another one of those slow, control-y decks in the Warrior.
I will say I would have liked to see Amnesiac play a Land Hands there at the end just to confirm that it's Counterspell, because he's pretty sure it's Counterspell. He's seen Duplicate, knows it's not Mirror Entity, but no reason not to make sure. But yeah, like you said, Zottl, that Warrior matchup is going to be a huge uphill battle for Talion.
Yeah.
Amnesiac really struggling with that Paladin right now. His draws just not coming together. In the first match, he got no card draw. In the second game, he got everything he needed, but not enough time to play that stuff.
Yeah, and was just short that quality that he needed at the end as well. After that, Dr. Boom had come down, if there wasn't a quality combo in the hand, that would have been a very, very different game from Amnesiac. Would have bought himself maybe as much as 4 or 5 extra turns to navigate through his card draw, pick up some more Murlocs, but just isn't tying it together yet with this deck, and that is kind of the issue. It is still a little bit inconsistent, a little bit unrefined at this point. So Amnesiac is struggling on the bad side of that right now, isn't getting the draws that he needs, but he has one more chance in a matchup which, regardless of the type of Warrior, is going to be favorable for him as the Paladin.
Yeah, if it ends up being Patron Warrior, there's almost no better answer to the card Grim Patron than Equality. It's kind of hard to whirlwind your Grim Patrons when they have one health.
Yep.
And if it's Control Warrior, again, great matchup for Paladin. The game's going to go long. You're going to get time to play both of your Anyfins and just end the game with huge amounts of burst damage.
Yeah, Anyfin is probably the best combo deck in the entire game to go up against that Warrior.
Yeah.
Control Warrior in general is like kind of a combo deck killer, because they can go so high on the HP with that armor up and with that tank up, but the Anyfin Paladin has so much damage potential that it doesn't really matter quite often.
Yeah, I mean, once the both Anyfins have been used, which you can afford to use them both quite late a lot of the time in the matchup, the Warrior is going to have to put together something like 70 to 80 armor to be able to resist both of them if you're able to cast them. So even though Warrior is classically the deck that outlasts all these finite damage decks, this deck, although it is a finite amount of damage, the number is extremely high.
Yeah, so being Amnesiac here, it is a bit frustrating to lose 2 games after you were on a 2-0 lead, but he does have to recognize this matchup. Losing to Temple Mage, not a huge deal. That was an unfavored matchup.
Right.
Now I have Warrior ahead of me. This looks really good. Being Talion, like being the Warrior in this matchup, what kind of like long-term big picture strategy do you think is best of eats for winning the game?
I think that if you get an aggressive hand, you can just go for it. But as desperate as it might be, I think that quite often you could also try to go for the game plan where you just like armor up, tank up, and keep playing those belchers and just try to get your life total high enough to survive both of the combos and brawl afterwards.
It depends really heavily on the makeup of the Warrior deck as well. Like a more classic control Warrior deck that plays, say, Alexstrasza into Grommash Deathspite combo can wait to see a few healing cards used and then pick the one moment to just try and do the 1-2 punch and push all in that way. But if you're playing the Warrior deck that's more common at the moment, that's just loaded up with removal, you have so many removal cards that just don't really interact that well with this deck because it's low on minions, and that like so much of your deck is dead that it's hard to even make that aggressive push because your hand's full of answers the whole time.
Yeah, it really is. And Talion, look at the Harrison Jones. That should help him out at some point to deal with a 2 silver champion and getting that extra draw.
And this is just kind of the hidden stealth power of the Anyfin deck in this matchup as well, is that Paladin hero power versus Warrior hero power, every turn that interaction happens, it moves slightly in favor of the Paladin. The first time it happens, obviously it's 1 power on board against 2 armor, but then that stacks up exponentially. So over a very, very long game, the Paladin hero power actually nets an advantage over the Warrior hero power.
Absolutely, and that has classically been like the main reason why Paladin is considered a favorite against the Warrior in almost any situation, aside from maybe some patron decks where the Paladin is not running equalities.
So we're just going to see the two Acolyte of Pains come down here to contest each other. Both players looking for some card draw. Amnesiac is going to take the initiative here and decide that his card draw is more important. Neither player actually had a decent answer to be able to prevent these Acolytes drawing. So just have the weird situation where everyone's happy. Acolytes say everyone can draw cards. This is fine. We'll both cycle.
Yeah, you can tell Talion hesitated on whether or not to play his Acolyte of Pain. A little bit frustrated he didn't have a weapon to deal with Amnesiac's Acolyte.
Right.
But he recognizes that the Paladin deck, being the combo deck in the matchup, every card that Amnesiac draws is more valuable than the card that the Warrior draws. Like, at this point, Talion might just want the most time possible to be able to armor up through things like Justicar, Trueheart, whereas Amnesiac just wants to cycle through his deck like very quickly and just get those Anyfins out.
Slam going to come down here on the Belcher, picks up a Shield Slam, which, again, we can already see this number of cards. Like, Belcher, sure, it's a nice target for some removal, but all these cards in hand right now, the Execute, the Shield Slam, etc., they just aren't going to have too much of a great target. Brawl is going to be reserved for pretty much the emergency situation where you need to clear a bunch of Murlocs. So you can already see so many cards in this matchup that can be dead, but if there's one card that isn't dead, it's that one that he just drew.
Justicar, Trueheart. If he does go for that game plan where you just don't let anything happen and hope to survive it, Justicar is definitely going to help because you will need that 60, 70, maybe even 80 armor.
Right.
Or 80 HP total.
And Talion definitely didn't feel too bad executing a Sludge Belcher, of course. He knows that the Murloc, the Anyfin deck, doesn't usually play any large minions that you need to be conservative with your removal for. So you can feel free to use Execute, Shield Slams, and things like Belcher, no problem.
Yep. How do you feel about the revenge here? Could it be the time? Because you might not need to save that for anything else. So, like, playing the revenge, executing a second Belcher.
It's definitely an option available to him. He could also just play the Justicar, and then if Amnesiac wants to trade his one power minions into that, maybe just kind of be okay with it. Follow up with a Shield Maiden Shield Slam on Belcher. There's definitely options here, and it's a tough turn for Talion for sure. But I think, personally, I would play the Justicar and just get that out while I can.
All right, he could also go with the Shield Maiden just to have the bigger minion on board, because there may be an argument that, you know, playing Justicar now, he might not be hero powering for the next couple of turns. He might be spending all his mana on resources. But as you said, with that Shield Slam in hand, he might want to save the Shield Maiden for the instant activator. But at the same time, the 5-5 body instead of the 6-3 body is actually more competitive right now. So yeah, it's like that's the line he's going to go and just try and fight for the board the honest way here with stats on his minions.
That's a very good point. Against an Anyfin deck with so many cards in hand, though, you can kind of assume that your minions aren't really going to be trading, right?
Right.
You can assume they have Aldor, Keeper of Uldumon, something like that.
Yeah, you can at least assume that when you say I'm going to fight for the board with stats, those stats are not actually your real stats. Everything you play has one attack.
Yeah, case in point, Humility. Interesting tech choice, by the way. Very cool to see that in a tournament setting of this caliber.
Yeah, and he's not playing just one, but he's actually playing two Humilities. He still has one in his hand after that one.
It kind of seems likely that seeing more and more of the deck now that some card draw has been cut, right?
Yeah.
To make space for the extra Belchers, the extra Humilities, it seems like it's a little bit lighter on
card
draw.
Loot Hoarder is the card that Amnesiac took out. He definitely wants to keep those Acolyte of Pains in there because of the good synergy with Humility and Aldor.
Right.
But yeah, back to Talion. He's going to decide what the best way to deal with this board is. He kind of wants to be conservative with that Brawl, like Savit said, for the double Anyfin. But if he plays two Brawls, it's not the worst idea to just throw one out in this case.
I mean, it seems like the most powerful play in this situation right now, but I really think that he should hold on to it.
And also, like, at this point, there's a consideration. You know, you haven't got out to a big lead early with your life total. You haven't really been able to build up a huge buffer. So yeah, I was going to say, maybe from Talion's perspective here, he feels like if the game lasts to the point where both Anyfins are going to get cast and he has to Brawl the first one, he's probably just lost anyway, so what does that Brawl really do? Just use it here so he can at least try and get a buffer down and start building up some protection.
Yeah, but it's just so hard to imagine that Talion closing out this game now with some damage. Like, the Chrome, yeah, that's a nice burst, but he needs to deal 20 damage before that, and how's he gonna do it?
So many Murlocs drawn for Amnesiac already, and it's only turn 7. I mean, this first Anyfin is going to be such a big threat.
Well then, that explains how you can afford to spend one of the Brawls.
Right. There is a reason why you don't need to keep a Brawl for destroying Murlocs. Deathwing does it just fine.
Yeah, as a counter, I rate that 12 out of 12.
Ah, but on to more important matters, and Talion has a board to address yet again here. He's able to deal with the first one with the Brawl, but it just immediately refills. The Blue Gear Warrior, a great draw just to stop putting on that Murloc pressure. Gets immediately buffed by the War Leader. Making sure here as well with this early chip damage from the early minions that the Warrior isn't building up that buffer of health. He's going to be comfortably in range of the Anyfins when they end up being played. Yeah. Just shield slamming Murlocs at will. Be gone!
Talion's being really conservative with this revenge of his. Just wanting to save that for a bit better of an opportunity, maybe as an enabler for his execute, because he doesn't really have another one.
Right.
Do Doomsayer your own body.
Well, when thinking about the tempo Doomsayer play, I think the most important thing is what is your follow-up.
Yeah,
in this case,
true.
If he played Doomsayer, he would have equally little to play the following turn. So turn 9 might be a decent turn to blow up your own board.
Wow, just goes for the Ultra Peacekeeper and Antique Healer, but both the minions having their battle cries completely wasted. But he has that Leon Hands in his hand, so he needs to get rid of some of the cards that he had just to be able to not burn anything when he goes for that extra card draw.
Right, and like with the Leon Hands in his hand and the card next to it, Humility, you know, he kind of has replacement effects for both of those anyway. If he needs healing, he can use the Leon Hands. If he needs to neutralize a minion, he still has the Humility. So also just valuing getting the pressure of those 3-3 minions on the board right now. Because Talion is consistently showing less than perfect answers to these situations with just a board of small minions.
And we're about to see the incredible synergy between Sludge Belcher and Armorsmith, though. Been around the game for so long now. And it's going to give Talion a little bit more life to play with. Make it not hurt so much that he can't deal with the board effectively for a turn.
Yeah, give this interaction a fond farewell, though, because we will be saying goodbye to our good friend Sludge Belcher very soon.
Yes, we will. Oh, board's going to be dealt with by Amnesiac. He's still got a lot on the table. He's got the board lead. He's got Anyfin. He's sitting in a good spot.
Absolutely. And still, the Warrior player in a slow matchup has not succeeded in getting his health above 40, so he has very little resistance to this massive amount of damage that's going to start coming in very soon. I believe one Blue Gear Warrior and both War Leaders have been played so far. Not quite enough, probably, to activate the first Anyfin just yet in such a slow matchup. He still has plenty of time. Probably just looking to use that Lay on Hand sometime in the near future, try and get at least one more Murloc down first.
Yeah, in this matchup, that stacking up the armor to ridiculously high amounts is certainly a reasonable strategy, but Talion has been unable to do it, and it's just he has a good amount of health. He's not in any danger of dying yet, but in the long run, it's actually a big deal that he's 36 right now and not 56 or so.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Harrison Jones has the potential to get some value against Amnesiac's best weapon right now. So Talion's considering the cards he could draw off the top of his stack to kind of deal with his board better. But he does have other lines of play involving Execute on a 3-2, which definitely doesn't feel too great. All right, he's just going to go with the Justicar, start arming up for a lot, try to kind of ignore the damage that Amnesiac's putting out. I like that play.
Yeah, the Justicar does finally come down, and we had this discussion on turn 6 about, you know, do we need to play Justicar right now? Because when do we next intend to Hero Power? Turns out by playing the Shield Maiden there instead of the Justicar, he has Hero Powered several times between then and now, so he has missed out on a great deal of armor overall by not playing the Justicar.
Yeah, that's a very good point. It's how those small decisions in the mid-game can end up having such huge repercussions later on with these control decks. We'll see what Talion can find to deal with his board. By playing Justicar that turn, he did remove his opportunity to use Harrison Jones for value, so that might end up being a huge deal.
Yeah, I mean, the Harrison Jones would not really get any better than it was last turn, so he's kind of thinking, okay, I don't need the Harrison, I don't need to destroy a Truce of a Champion with it. Dead Spite from the top, that should help a little bit with what the challenge that he's facing right now.
Yeah, first weapon from Talion.
Right.
Pretty late in his deck. I mean, this is how the Warrior is supposed to kind of ignore the, you know, mid-game weak minions that the Paladin throws out. It's been pretty unfortunate for Talion to not have drawn one up to this point, but he does have it now that'll help him sort of keep up with what's going on the board at the moment.
Yeah, this entire situation with just a couple of 3-3s, the odd Sludge Belcher, and a bunch of Hero Powers, this entire pressure from about turn 5 up until right now gets completely shut down by one Deathspite if it was drawn in the mid-game. So the fact that he hasn't been there is such a huge deal. It's what's allowed Amnesiac to be ahead of this game the whole time. He's going to continue cycling now with the Solemn Vigil that he picked up off the Leon hands, which is one of the great things about combo decks is your card draw tends to compound on each other. Once you start getting in a comfortable position and casting these card draw cards, they draw into more card draw cards, and suddenly your deck shrinks very, very quickly.
Just look at the amount of damage these minions have been putting out for Amnesiac. It's over 20 damage at this point.
Oh, easily, yeah.
That all would have just been armor stacking up on Talion's side. And another interesting point from Amnesiac's side about how he's playing this is he had the opportunity to drop the first Anyfin and get, you know, three Murlocs off of it,
yep,
and make a pretty reasonable board. But he realizes that Talion's line of winning involves kind of armoring up as much as possible. So Amnesiac's making sure that not just the second Anyfin, but the first Anyfin has as big of an impact as possible. He's going to wait till he draws that Murkai and the second Bluegill potentially.
Now, this is a secondary win condition for Talion in form of Alexstrasza, if he has that card in his deck. Because with that, he could potentially set his opponent down to 15 and have access to that that Grom and maybe some weapon attacks to finish him off. Because Amnesiac has played a lot of his healing effects.
Yes. One Healbot was used for very little value, one Lay on Hands was used just to draw cards, but okay, Bluegill Warrior is now drawn. That's the fourth Murloc, and most importantly, the second Charge Murloc that he's been able to activate. The charges are the things that you really need to have the source of damage, and the buffs from the War Leader are pretty much auxiliary to increase the power of those charges. And so the Bluegill Warrior will probably be used here for utility to help punch through this this Deathlord. No? Okay, interesting. He's gonna keep it alive.
Amnesiac recognizes that the Deathbite is still primed over on Talion's side and wants to trade off his one health minions because they will die anyway. Develops the board a bit more.
I mean, it's the same thing, right? You either have two 1-1s or a 2-1. They're both going to die to the Deathbite either way, so it's the same situation.
I guess if the last War Leader was pulled out, then there was more damage to face with the blue
I think
kill.
Both War Leaders are already gone.
Both War Leaders are gone, okay. Yeah. So, it's pretty much the same thing, yeah. I guess.
Well, I think Talion's hard-pressed to hold on to Deathbite for yet another turn here. I expect him to see him make that attack. He's considering things like Gromash, knows that Amnesiac is going to have access to at least one Equality. He's drawn almost his entire deck at this point.
That hand from Talion, nothing seems very good here.
And it's definitely a rough position to be in. Maybe, I mean, at this stage, you can't really go for the armor line of play anymore, right? You've never had control of the board, so maybe you just drop Sylvanas, just eat some damage.
I think that's the only play. It's not great, but nothing else makes any sense, to be honest.
Yeah, the fact that you've never been on this board also means that your opponent has never been pressured to use their Equalities, so you're pretty confident that Equality is going to be in your opponent's hand. So even the situation of, you know, eventually fighting back onto this board with huge minions like Grom and Deathwing, you know that's not going to pay out because you just haven't had the pressure down as of yet to force those Equalities out of your opponent's hand.
Now, the Amnesiac evaluating here if he wants to go for the first anything right now.
Yep, yeah, so if I've kept track of the Murlocs correctly, he'd have 12 damage immediately to two Bluegill Warriors, both being buffed twice by the War Leaders. So it's a good starting point, and it gives him a decent enough platform for that second Anyfin to come down, but it looks like he's going to go for the all-in line and wait till that Murkai is drawn, because Murkai is the card that really amplifies the damage of your eventual Anyfin combos.
Yeah, Amnesiac recognizes that he has a lot of life to play with. There's no immediate reason to rush the first Anyfin out. He's going to get full value out of both of them.
Yep, very true. And again, this play with the double Doomsayer, more than anything, is along the line of something Savitz mentioned earlier, is that he probably just wants to draw more cards now, and he needs to get cards out of his hand so that Lay on Hands is able to be used.
Yep, and Talion going to use a Bash here as well to get a little bit of extra armor. Kind of signals that the Alexstrasza is probably not in the deck.
Sorry, vaguely amusing. And just like, hey, I'll just deal 8 damage to you right now.
Yeah.
Just go ahead. Oh, okay, he's just going to set up the board clear here. He is going to go ahead with the 12 damage with the two Bluegill Warriors. And yeah, I think this is fine. I think between the two War Leaders here, I'm not going to stop and do the maths exactly while I'm casting, but between the two Anyfins here, he should have enough damage to get to have the Warrior covered.
Absolutely. It's a great position to be with Amnesiac. I'm not seeing a way Talion can claw his way out of this. He's almost pressured to play Deathwing before the second.
Yeah, and there it is. Talion just gives it up, realizes that there's no way he can beat that second Anyfin coming down, even if he had an answer for that one, which he did with the Deathwing. Not going to be good enough. Amnesiac had to do it the hard way, got out to a 2-0 lead. Fight back did come from Talion, but Amnesiac with that deck, as we said, was extremely favored in at least two of those matchups, able to clutch it out in the end.
Yeah, he really struggled a bit to find that win, but he did so in the end, and it looked like a fairly convincing win. There was nothing really, like, there was no point in the game where it felt like, oh, Talion is going to take it. It was just like Amnesiac show all the way in that game five.
I mean, that's definitely the advantage of bringing these decks with very polarizing matchups to a format like Conquest, because if you do get out to that early lead, as long as that Paladin deck cues into one of your favorite matchups, you're going to take the series. So, yeah, I mean, awesome deck choice from Amnesiac. I'm really happy you got to see that in a tournament of this caliber. Very cool deck.
Yeah, and even better than that, not only did he have the one favorable matchup, but we saw he had that buffer to lose the one very favorable matchup where he just had that terrible draw with no card draw. He still had that Warrior matchup to fall back on afterwards. Talion from his side, not out of the tournament just yet, still has a second chance to come back into this. But you know, he's going to need to try and back up some of that confidence that we saw in the video a bit more heavily. And also Amnesiac overcoming his unfavorable win rate against Talion overall there.
Yeah. Amnesiac looking good now in the winner's bracket. I'm excited to see some more of that Murloc action going forward.
Awesome. Well, let's take a trip over to Fireside with Frodan, and we are just about ready with a winner's interview. Frodan, Amnesiac, how are you guys doing?
Well, I know one person who's really happy about how that series went. Amnesiac, again, a very interesting take on what you brought to the metagame. What inspired you to bring it specifically? Was there a person, or is this an idea that you thought for a long time that this Paladin was great to bring?
Well, Murloc Paladin's pretty polarizing deck overall. It has some really, really good matchups, like you saw. Like, I would say Handlock's one of them, even though I actually never got to practice that matchup because very few people play Handlock. Tempo Mage, I was expecting him to play Freeze, which is really bad for it. Like, that's an 80-20 matchup in the Freeze's favor. But then when I saw the Tempo Mage, that's also, like, a doable matchup. And Control Warrior is probably the best matchup for Murloc Paladin in the game. So I was happy to see he brought that rather than Patron, which is more of a flip.
How much going into this series did you know about Talion? It feels like Talion studied a ton of other players, but you were mentioning in a lot of your interviews before this championship that, you know, you're just really focused on yourself and the other players you're not really too worried about. Did you have a lot of information going in knowing his type of style? Because he brought a very interesting set of choices with his decks.
Well, he brought very similar classes to prelims, so I thought that would mean he'd bring similar decks, but he actually switched it up quite well. So he brought Druid over Paladin, which is to be expected. There's a lot of control in the field. You definitely want Druid at this tournament. But then he chose to bring Handlock over Renolock, which was unexpected, and I'm interested to see how that will do in the tournament, because Handlock's also a pretty strong deck in a control format. And then he brought Tempo Mage rather than Freeze, which I don't know if you saw, but on turn two, when he unstable portals, my eyes kind of bugged out, because I just didn't see that coming at all. And then he brought Control Warrior over Patron, which I also think is a safer pick in this tournament. So I liked his deck choices. I liked to see that he switched it up. It was a great series.
You mentioned that at tournaments, you do get nervous, but it never affects your play. Do you think that still carries over to this tournament specifically?
Yeah, I was really happy with how I played that series.
All right, cool. Well, I mean, that's pretty much it. Congratulations. You have one more series against Nostam. Do you feel like this is the group that you're going to advance from in first place here?
Nostam's a great player. He's a good friend. It should be some great games, and we'll see.
All right, wow. Very humble for you, and congratulations on your win. Let's head over to the sidebar and check in with TJ, Rob, and Core and see what they thought about that series as well.
Thanks very much, Dan and Amnesiac. Yeah, what a match that was. I mean, coming in, that was quite the polar opposite from match number one, where we saw a lot of fast decks, especially from Chalky. And we come into this one, it's basically control versus control. So, Core, let's jump right into the lineups here. Mm-hmm. A very bold choice from Amnesiac to bring both Murloc Paladin and Rogue. Talk to me a little bit about that.
Yeah, for sure. We see a lot of Paladins in this tournament, but we were definitely expecting mostly Secret Paladins. So to see that Murloc Paladin was, I'm sure, a surprise for everyone, which is probably what he was going for. If you bring a deck that is going to catch everybody off guard, you have a better chance of winning with it. So I actually really like bringing that more combo-style Paladin deck. And then the Rogue, Amnesiac is just a really confident player, very confident with his Rogue play. And I, for one, am not surprised that he brought it. And it ended up working out really well.
Yeah, and Rob, he had, even though the control war wasn't that bold of a choice, he still brought cool cards like the Gorehowl, which got all the way down to 2 durability before it went out. So tell me a little bit about that card inclusion, the Gorehowl.
So Gorehowl back in the day in Control Warrior was actually one of the staple cards for a while. You just ran a one-off copy of it, and it generates so much card advantage because you're able to just clear out minions. And as you said, it got down to really low durability, so he was certainly getting his money's worth. And it's important to have the ability to generate that card advantage because when you're playing against a Handlock, they naturally have life tap, so they're just drawing cards all the time. Yeah. So it's kind of an equalizer, and we saw, you know, Amnesiac was just cutting down minions left and right. Talion was still drawing cards, so it was still a really hard-fought match for him.
Yeah, so we have a clip from game one, which sort of set the pace for Amnesiac in this matchup. Mm-hmm. He went into a tough matchup. It's Control Warrior versus Handlock, which traditionally has been a tough matchup for the Control Warrior player. And we can see here in game one that he was in a situation where we're getting close to fatigue, and he's got a tough decision ahead of him after the Harrison Jones. So we can go ahead and roll the clip. And Cora, walk me through a little bit of the Control Warrior versus Handlock matchup and what you're looking for to sort of close out the game.
For sure. It's a tough matchup. A little bit favored on the Warlock side, definitely just because of Lord Draxxus.
Yeah.
So for Amnesiac to have this Harrison Jones, get rid of Lord Draxxus minion, and draw himself 7 cards is the equalizer that he needed, especially in a match like this, where he had just lost the brawl, leaving the Taunted Molten Giant on board, giving Talion so much more power. So Amnesiac being able to get rid of Draxxus' weapon, draw himself 7 cards, refill his hand, and now they're both equal on fatigue. So they're both fatiguing at the same time, but Amnesiac is so far ahead as far as cards. So he goes ahead and takes 8 damage to the face right here, which seems really risky, but Rob, it actually paid off.
Yeah, he absolutely realizes that, you know, he was behind on fatigue by quite a bit. Harrison's draws 7 cards there, only then catches up to Talion on fatigue, and then from there, Talion's sitting on 3 cards, right? And aside from the hero power from Draxxus, there's really nothing else stopping Amnesiac from just pressing that card advantage, takes a damage, and, you know, ultimately wins the game.
Yeah, and that sort of, again, set the pace for the rest of the match. In the second match with the Rogue versus Demon Handlock matchup, Talion was playing super defensively, and it was probably because he went into a matchup with Control Warrior and Handlock that's unfavored, or seemingly unfavored, and he took out the wins. That forced Talion to play defensive. Do you think that's going to play into his psyche throughout the rest of the tournament?
I would hope not. You think, especially since he was able to come back and make it only a 3-2 victory for Amnesiac, that, you know, things happen. The Warrior does win the Warrior versus Warlock matchup occasionally. It's just the way that the game goes. So hopefully he's not going to let it really get to him to affect the rest of his matches. Right. I think it was more of a, you know, Harrison Jones happens. Sometimes your opponent draws 7 cards and it doesn't feel good. But no, I don't think it's going to hold him back in the rest of the day.
And Rob, now that we've seen these guys' decks, what do you think Amnesiac's chances are of advancing first in this group?
I have to say, I feel really good about his odds. He's, you know, we were talking to him yesterday at lunch, and we were talking to him a little bit about his lineup, and he was very candid about the fact he brought Rogue, which is a class that I've heard a lot of people say that they do not consider Rogue one of the core classes because they don't think it's very good. But Amnesiac pretty much said that if you know how to play Rogue correctly and you're good at Rogue, it's one of the best classes in the game. So we mentioned earlier kind of at the beginning of this, he's got that confidence, he's got that swagger, and I'm really excited to see what he can do.
All right, well, that's going to be it for that one as we wrapped it up. But we are going to go into the next match shortly. But while we wait, check out some highlights of the action from that match.